So you're probably on your Easter evening, and hopefully it went great for you. And I'm here, and it's about 1:30 in Pacific Standard Time here in California. And I'm putting on my surgical gloves. This is tough. I don't know if I can get these. There you go. Thumbs on. We are going to have an Easter-themed presentation here today, but probably be unlike anything you've ever heard. If I can get this glove on. I don't know if I can. Sometimes it's not easy, right? It's not good. It's just not, it just doesn't want to. The fingers don't want to go in properly, right? Oh well. I'll just take it off then. Take it off. So this is very symbolic. This glove represents our death vows, and they just don't work, right? Our death vows, what we vowed to never give up death until it succeeded in circumventing the impossibility of us being prior to and causative of reality, reversing the direction of creation, doing the impossible. So we have these. Now I'm having trouble getting this off. Oh no, that won't come off of there. Get off of there. Wow. Tough, huh? So this glove represents our death vows. And we made all these vows. We vowed to not stop this death dream until it succeeded. And then we also vowed to never go look at these vows. It's taboo to ever look at these vows. They're deep, 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 deep down in our subconscious mind. Very in the deepest, darkest recesses of our subconscious mind, so to speak, there's this area where we have all these vows. And that's like to us, it's sacrosanct. That's the no one may enter there. We vowed to never enter there. And we believe these vows as we keep constantly telling ourselves that that we've opted out of now and opted into I, opted out of eternity and opted into time. Okay? We made these vows to opt out of reality into a dream of death. And we're continuously repeating these vows over and over and over and over and over and over and over. Now, to get free of these vows is what we are doing. Okay. Oh, that last one is stuck. Okay. Almost free of the vows. 94% free of the vow. The vows. So this morning, I've been working on it intensely. Opting out of I, just opting out of I, opting out of I. I start like that, opting out of I, opting out of I, opting out of I, opting out of I, opting out of I. So start out easy, opting out of I, opting out of I, opting out of I, opting out of I. Did that for a long time, opting out of I, opting out of I. And whew, this is reversing one of our most basic death vows, okay? So instead of opting out of I, just opting out of I, added adjust, just opting out of I, just opting out of I, just opting out of I, just opting out of I. So can I get this off? Wow, I got the death glove off here. I gotta sanitize it now. Come on, this death glove. Wow, Lysol. Yeah, could open the window here. Woo! Got some Lysol on my face. I gotta throw this thing out. Oh, okay. Where's Let me clean up the sanitize the glove here. Opting out of I, 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 opting out of I. Opting out of I, 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 opting out of I. So on this Easter morning, opting out of I. Wow, that Lysol thing is not good. We put a little hand sanitizer to get rid of that Lysol. We got a sanitizer to get rid of the sanitizer, right? Whew. Opting out of I, just opting out of I, just opting out of I, just opting out of I. So I had just opting out of I, just opting out of I. Just opting out of I, 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 just opting out of I. Now, this is with Easter we have this motif. Okay, since we're Easter, we're going to show you this Easter motif. And if you could read that there. Okay. You see the cross where Jesus was crucified. That represents the death, our death vows. Okay, so you come into this world to fulfill your death vows, to die. So then Jesus was put in this tomb. You see, that's the stone that's rolled away from the tomb. He was put in a tomb. So being put in the tomb means you have the capacity to go into your deep subconscious mind where these death vows are and reverse them and relinquish these vows. Reverse the death vows and then relinquish these death vows. When you do that, you experience what's called this eternal life feeling. And so Jesus coming out, resurrecting, coming out of the tomb means he successfully reversed and relinquished these death vows and now was born again into a new life, eternal life, divine life. That's exactly what Easter means. Okay, nothing more and nothing less. And he tells us, the thing about Easter for Christians is so important, and for everyone really, is we're being told for sure, Jesus said, look, what I did, you can do as well. All of you. I just showed you it's possible. You didn't think it was possible. I showed you, yes, you can do this. So it's an enormous promise to all of us. Easter is the time when we realize there's this promise to us that we can get free of death. That's what it's all about. Because there's just these death vows. We vowed to leave eternity, not stop dying until we could get free of eternity, and get free of eternal life, get free of reality. We vowed to do that. We can reverse and relinquish those vows. And when we relinquish the vows of trying to, you know, reject eternity, what's there? Eternity. Automatically. We're just trying to reject reality. We're trying to be prior to and causative of reality. We want to be reverse the direction of creation. We felt the impossibility of this. We then believed impossible was split into two of possible and obstruction of possible. We then took this vow to have possible destroy obstruction of possible to make impossible possible. So we have these vows, and we vowed to never stop these vows until we succeeded. And so we come here in this world because we're part of a death cult. Okay, we're part of a death cult. To get free of this death cult, there is a way. And it's a psychological way. We do this type of psychological dancing. And so I've trained myself to be a psychological dancer. You go into the tomb, this tomb of death. You're enclosed by stone, by inorganicness. Inorganicness. Inorganic nature to us represents success in destroying reality. So organic nature represents that which dies, which obstructing success and dies back into inorganic nature. So Jesus is in this tomb of stone. And yet in this tomb of stone, that's all our vows are there, the deep subconscious mind. If you practice in the right way, you can reverse those vows and then ultimately relinquish them. That's Jesus' promise to us. And so to really believe in Jesus is to actually practice. Do this practicing. That shows that you do trust him, his promise, and actually believe that it's possible. So here, we do trust that promise, and we absolutely believe it's possible. So the psychological dancing, first you can start out real quick, just opting out of I. Just a two-step, opting out of I. And then just opting out of Y, just opting out of Y, just opting out of Y, just opting out of I, just opting out of I, just opting out of I. It gives a little bit of syncopation to the practice. It just opting out of I, 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 just opting out of I. And then you can do a four step, just opting out of I and opting in the now, just opting out of I and opting in the now, just opting out of I and opting in the now, just opting out of I and opting in the now. See how it goes? That's a little more four step. So you go back to this, just a simple two step, just opting out of I, 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 opting out of I. So Then you go just opting out of I, just opting out of I, just opting out of I and opting into now, just opting out of I and opting into now. I is anomaly and now is now. I is anomaly and now is now. Just opting out of I and opting into now. I is anomaly and now is now. Just opting out of I and opting into now. I is anomaly and what now is now. Just opting out of I and opting into now. I is anomaly and now is now. Just opting out of I and opting into now. I is anomaly and now is now. So then you get a little more complicated like that, a little more dancing to it. And it's adding on some more sophistication to what you're practicing. First opting out of I, and then just opting out of I, and then opting out of I and opting into now. So you are reversing the whole situation. Your vow is not to opt out of your vow is not to opt into I, it's to opt out of I and opt into now. So reversing the vow. Now, I forgive myself and relinquish the vow of opting into I and opting out of now. So that's another way of practicing. I forgive myself and relinquish the vow of opting into I and opting out of now. So if you're forgiving yourself and wanting to relinquish that vow, that sets your purpose for your practicing, the next practicing. It sets the purpose, and then you say, okay, so I'm going to reverse the idea of opting into I, and I say just opting out of I, opting out of I, opting out of I, opting out of I, and then what do we opt into? Oh, and opting into now, opting out of I and opting into now. So that's reversing this death vow. Now, how do we know that these death vows in there? Okay, trust me, there are. But you will find out yourself. You have to find out for yourself in that when you are saying this, just opting out of I, just opting out of I, just opting out of I, just opting out of I. If you keep doing it, keep doing it, keep doing it, eventually you'll feel like something like starts to overtake you, like you blank out. So you go into a sort of a hazy, blanked out state for a moment. And then suddenly you'll be aware, like, well, wait a minute. You find out that the practice has been reversed on you. And you're automatically saying, just opting into I, just opting into I. And you say, whoa, that just reversed it. That shows you that this inner vowing is there already, and it tries to push back, and you try to, it pulls you back into your old habits. So when you try to break old habits, you will find that you get pulled back into them. So this is what I discovered in doing this really in-depth practice in this tomb, deep subconscious tomb-like area that we have, that these successfully practicing, it turns out that these old habits try to reverse what you're doing and go back to the old habits. And you become like in the grip of it. You say, whoa, stop. And then you reverse it back like that. And it's kind of a struggle that goes on. There, you feel the psychological struggle going on. That tells you that these old habits are very much there. They're very much in charge, and they're used to being in charge. And so it's like, how dare you come in here and try to reverse this? That's taboo. I say, no, it's not. I'm forgiving myself and relinquishing my vows of opting into I and opting out of now. Because that's what we can do. We're given permission to do that by Jesus and other great teachers also. But today's Easter, we'll say, Jesus, that you can do this. You absolutely, and you have to do this, because these death vows accomplish nothing. They do not enable us to circumvent impossibility. They accomplish nothing for us at all. It does not accomplish suitability for us. The perfect suitability of reality. It does not do that. And never. So we have to relinquish these vows, and it's a struggle. It's an interesting struggle. You go back to the old habits. So just opting out of I, 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 just opting out of I and opting into now, just opting out of I and opting into now. So don't get rattled if you find yourself reversing this. That just shows you, oh, that those old habits are indeed there. They most certainly are. Just opting out of I and opting into now. Just opting out of I and opting into now. Just opting out of I and opting into now. I is an anomaly and now is now. Just opting out of I and opting into now. I is an anomaly and wow and now is now. Just opting out of I and opting into now. I is an anomaly and now is now. There's another way to do it, just opting out of I and opting into now. I is anomaly, and anomaly is wow. I is anomaly, and anomaly is wow. So this is another way of practicing to just dismiss all anomaly of the old ways of I as just simply an anomaly, which means it's not even worth looking at. Just dismiss it. Just an anomaly. It's just wow. Just label it as wow, dismissed. Okay, so that's called relinquishing the old vows. It's reversing, and then you relinquish the old vows. It's just an anomaly. So opting out of I and opting into now, I is an anomaly, and anomaly is wow. Just opting out of I and opting into now, I is an anomaly, and anomaly is wow. Just opting out of I and opting into now, I is anomaly, and anomaly is wow. Just opting out of I and opting into now, I is anomaly, and anomaly is wow. Just opting out of I and opting into now, I is anomaly, and anomaly is wow. Just opting out of I and opting into now, I is anomaly, and anomaly is wow. Like that, and then just go back. Opting out of I, opting out of I, opting out of I, opting out of I. So when you start with this real easy, simple thing, as you get a little more complex and assertive about it all, you could take a breath and just go back to the simple two-step. Just go opting out of I, 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 opting out of I. Now, to go through this ordeal of the tomb, Jesus in the tomb, to go in there with him and do this work, it's difficult work, and it's best done. Basically it's best done in a situation where you are not having to showcase yourself as Mr. or Mrs. Leader and example to everybody in the world of how to be happy and beautiful and effective and you know, alpha female, alpha male, like I'm on top of the world. I'm doing everything right. You know, all the flowers in my yard are perfect. The yard is perfect. My clothes are perfect. My job is perfect. My kids are perfect. Everything's perfect. That's not going to really work very well for you. It's better to have like a very much of a low-key life, a very low-key life, where you're not seen as being in a position of high responsibility, because this work is very tiring. Just like dancing, if you dance for 3 hours, really electro shuffle fast dancing, you know, you're going to be just absolutely exhausted. Even if you're young, it's going to exhaust you. The struggle against these old vows is fraught with trepidation on our part. So it's tiring, and you're not going to be at your best by any means. So the more isolated you are, the more like a hermit you are, the better it is for you on this path. That's a blessed life. Like my life has been like a hermit. I've been like a recluse hermit. My whole life, I basically just spent my time in a room, inside in a room, just sitting in a chair. But I'm practicing. I'm working on all of this. Gearing up to practice, and we'll talk about this now, is that Jesus, let me give this example. Like we have Buddhism, which is started out as Theravada Buddhism, and then it came along a different style of Buddhism called Mahayana, the great vehicle, and they called the other one Hinayana, the small vehicle. And what they said was that this Theravada Buddhism was too slow. It was like saying thousands of lifetimes you need to finish this. They said, no, you can do it in one lifetime. That was a big, big, big shift in perspective. You could do it in one lifetime. And then Tibetan Buddhism came in, Vajrayana Buddhism came into Tibet, which you know, really even accelerated Mahayana Buddhism. You can do it in one lifetime. Okay, this is the whole thing. Do it this life. There is a way to do it. So now Christianity started out, and it's been around for 2,000 years now. Judeo-Christianity has been around longer than that. And Jesus recently came back to this world in a certain way, not physically, but psychologically. He made a psychological return to this world through what we call A Course in Miracles. And what he basically said is you can finish this freedom from death. You can finish this life. You can do it in one life. Okay, there's a fast way to do it. So that's a very much of equivalent of Mahayana to Theravada Buddhism, or Vajrayana Buddhism to Theravada Buddhism, saying, look, you can do it in one life. Very strong equivalency like that. So A Course in Miracles is a psychological return of Jesus saying, look, here's how you do it fast. You're going too slow right now. You know, it's time to pick up the pace because we got problems coming, folks. Remember, A Course in Miracles, I think it's started back, it started back, what, 1967, 1966, 1967, Helen Schuckman heard this voice. Published in 1974, and then I think 1976 it really became available to the public at large. I started in 1978, so that's quite a long time ago. I know. Remember the 1960s? Yeah, some of us do. Well, this partially remember them, you know. I mean, it was kind of stressful time. Like, kind of like now, except now's worse. It's going to get worse than the 60s. So, 30, 40, you know, 1970, 40, almost 50 years, you know, it's been around, let's say. Let's give it like virtually 50 years. If you take it 1970, it's now 2020. That's like 50 years. So let's give A Course in Miracles 50 years right now at this point, because in 1970 it was starting to, you know, there was starting to be a little bit of percolation in a small group of people, and so it was you know, happening. It was in the works. This is a psychological return of Jesus, and in this psychological return, he said, "This is how you do it fast." Now, he gave out this theory and then a workbook of practicing. Now, the theory was so advanced and brilliant. I fell in love with the theory. Okay, I said, oh my gosh, this is what I've been waiting for. This explains theory better than anything. This is fantastic explanation. So I love the theory, and I read the theory over hundreds of times. I mean, I studied it, stayed like you can't believe, 16 hours a day, you know, year after year after year, studying the theory. But I didn't really get into the workbook so much. I tried, but I had a hard time. And ultimately what happened was, I loved the theory so much that I really didn't get with the practicing properly. And then Jesus tells us, look, if you just take my theory and don't do the practice, it's not going to work for you. You're not going to reach the goal. And I said, uh-oh, I'm in trouble here. I'm in big trouble, because I thought the theory alone could do it. I loved it so much, I want to tell everybody about the theory. It's so fantastic. But I wasn't cleaning out these deep subconscious vows, you see. I wasn't getting to them properly. Not yet. So I stalled out. And then what happened was some other teachers came along who were able to induce practicing in me. They were able to get me to eventually realize I had to practice. I said, no, I understand Jesus, what he's saying. I don't need to practice. And I had to kind of go away from A Course in Miracles for a while, really, I did. I had to drop it, and I was able to work with some great, you know, divine life teachers who were liberated from death also, but they didn't focus on theory at all. They only focused on trying to get me to practice. And so eventually I fell in love with practicing. So now I have the love of theory and the love of practicing. So that's called a balanced approach. That's difficult to get to. A very, very balanced approach right now. So I'm equally comfortable with great theory and great practice. But practice is essential. You can't do it just with theory. You cannot. These vows, deep subconscious vows, are like constant mantras going on. We're continuously saying these vows to ourselves subconsciously. All right, you hear that? That subconsciously, all of us are nonstop repeating these vows to die. I opt into I, or opting into I, and opting out of now, opting out of I. You know, we're constantly repeating these death vows to ourselves subconsciously. We're not even aware of it. Consciously, we're not aware of it, but that's what we're doing constantly. So we have to go into that deep subconscious tomb-like area, death area, and start reversing these vows, and then getting to the point of relinquishing them. That's difficult. Okay, it's not easy. And so you when you're doing this, you're going to be stressed out and you're going to be tired and you're not going to like look so beautiful or fresh. You're not going to be dressed so perfectly. You're not going to be walking around with great poise and alertness and like, I'm in charge, you know, I'm in charge, you know, that kind of thing. You're going to be schlepping around. And you say, God, I hope nobody really like is like paying much attention to me, you know. Well, if you live a life that is pretty isolated and you don't have a lot of friends and social contacts and commitments and responsibilities, then there's not too many people who are going to be looking at you, okay? So you can schlep around and you can say, I hope nobody's looking at me. And you realize nobody is. And you say, oh, great. Because I'm kind of like functioning at like 10% right now, you know. I'm tired, you know. I'm really poof. Wow, that was a battle I had. So I've been waking up at like 4 a.m. for years and years and years now. And then spending that time practicing until I get up. And on work days, you know, it depends, it's variable. But sometimes 3 to 4 hours before I even get up to go to work. Weekends, sometimes 6 to 7 hours of practicing, sleeping in. But I'm actually practicing intensely, doing the psychological dance. And then during the day while driving, I drive for a living, I will tape just so I practice, get me to practice. I'll tape like sometimes 2 to 3 hours every day of, depending, you know, it's between 1 and 3 hours of taping, but usually more like 2 hours of taping a day. Practicing every single day. So I might be doing 8 to 10 hours of practice a day. It adds up. And also during the day, trying to always remember to keep practicing during the day. And by the nighttime, I'm tired, you know, really from that. And then I try to give one more burst of effort before I go to bed and make sure, you know, end it on a high note. But then, poof, wow, that's enough for the day. I can't do any more. And you become, you know, you're not functioning optimally. You know, really, and people look at you like, oh, that person's really suboptimal. You know, suboptimal. And that sort of crushes your dignity if there's a lot of people around looking at you that way, saying, what's wrong with them? You know, they're not really with it. They've just made some mistakes. They're kind of absent-minded. Well, I'm absent-minded because I'm saying, look, opting out of I and opting into now. So, yeah, I may be absent-minded. So people have a, you know, feel like I don't have many people around me, because if they do, they'd say, this guy, you know, he's not entirely with it. He's absent-minded. His mind's off somewhere. I don't know where it is. And he's kind of not really with it that much. And, you know, he's not really, you know, Mr. Efficiency or something, you know, Mr. Take Charge Efficiency. So they kind of think like, I'm a suboptimal person. They don't know. And I can't explain to them because they would say, ah, stay away from me, you're crazy. They don't know that I've gone into this tomb and I'm clearing out all these death vows. They don't realize that. So they won't realize you're doing it. People will not realize you're doing it, and you better not tell them, because they're not going to like that. Most people are very strict adherents to the death cult here. And they say, don't, you know, they think, if I'm really good and I don't go into that subconscious death vault, vault of death vows, then God's going to reward me with a heavenly life after I die. That's what they say. That's what they say, right? If I'm really loyal to death, I'm going to get a big reward for that, you know. So they train themselves to not go into those subconscious death vows. They say, no, God doesn't want me to do that. Well, the God of absurdity doesn't want you to do that, but absurdity is not a God. That's just us trying to deify ourselves as if we're prime creator. And because absurdity is just a strategy of trying to circumvent us from being, you know, greater than God, prior to God. It's not God. So God does allow us to go into that subconscious area and relinquish these vows. Jesus said that's God allows you to do that. You don't have to. God doesn't force any experiencing upon us. You're free to experience this nonsense death dream if you want. But God certainly allows you to relinquish these death vows also. And I'm showing you that I'm doing this and I'm able to, you know, be in the presence of the always honest yesing light, and it's responding to me perfectly right now. Okay, so that does, you don't get rejected for that. So he showed us, you do not, God does not reject you if you do this. Absurdity will try and reject you, but absurdity is not God. Okay, but when you try to get in there, absurdity is going to say, you're blaspheming God. You know, God put these death vows in there for a purpose. And no, God didn't put any death vows in there. We put the death vows in there for a purpose of trying to be greater than God, reversing the direction of creation. And so, water break, how we doing?
Well, it's the 30-minute mark.
Good. But certainly, you experience trepidation. So what we're doing here is we're at least helping everyone here a little bit, maybe a lot, easing some of that trepidation. Okay, this is really important. That's why it's really important to be aware that there's others who have done this. The problem with this blackout now that's going on in the world, that started January 12th, 2020, we're going into this era where it's trying to black out all of the remembrance and awareness that there are those who have done this in the past, and all of the help that's available, and all the inner psychological dance that we're able to do. Black all of that out, saying that whole thing is taboo, it's a waste of time, you're a bunch of crazy idiots trying to do that, and just focus on material abundance. Okay, that's called going into zone four. And, you know, this Easter, you know, people I'm around, fortunately, some people did give me an Easter card and say, He is risen. You know, that's an Easter, you say, He is risen from the dead. The whole point of that. But most people in society here at this point, it's like say, yeah, Easter is a very nice time. It's a time of spring renewal. You know, the flowers are growing, life's returning to the plants. And you know, it's, you know, a pagan, they have a pagan, you know, feeling towards it. But that's the pagan festival of Easter was replaced by Christianity with this all-important promise of Jesus that I rose from the dead and you can too. If you follow this way and you will also rise from the dead. I promise you this. And Jesus is promising us this very day in his recent psychological return to this world. He promises very directly. He says, you do these practices, okay, and you will rise from the dead. You will no longer be held by death. All right, you'll get free of this death, these death vows. You will succeed. You will succeed. You will succeed. So he's telling us, you will succeed and you'll do it this life. You will do it fast and you'll do it this life. No more return cyclic lies for you. You're going to get free of that. So he's very adamant that we can do this. So although Easter is a traditional, the slow Christian approach for slow Christianity, slow path Christianity, it's still very valid. It is still very, very valid. It's entirely valid that there is a way for us to rise from the dead, so to speak, to get rid of those death vows. That's what it means. And since, again, we vowed to try and leave our eternal, perfect, eternal home and life, when we relinquish those vows, we're accepting our perfect home and eternal life. And then we're just delighting in this unquenchable abundance of delighting, of endless delighting, an unquenchable abundance of endless delighting, an unquenchable abundance of endless delighting. Okay, that's our home. So when we relinquish these death vows, what we experience is this unquenchable abundance of endless delighting. An unquenchable abundance of endless delighting. It's an abundance that can never be quenched. Unquenchable. Okay? Whereas in this world, everything is quenchable, isn't it? We're vowing to be out, that there's a way to quench this, to put it out, like pour water on the fire and put the fire out. In reality, there's no way to quench this abundance. It's endless delighting, unquenchable abundance. Endless delighting, unquenchable abundance. Endless unquenchable delighting abundance. Any way you want to put it. Unquenchable abundance of endless delighting. 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 This is reality. And we vowed to reject that reality. But it's just a vow. And it's an empty vow because it doesn't work. We cannot separate ourselves from this. It's always with us. It's always with us. It's unquenchable. So how could we quench, put it out? We can't put it out. We can't turn the always on this yesing light off. We cannot turn it off. It's impossible. So we just have these vows to keep imagining this dream of dying. But when we relinquish, reverse and then relinquish these vows, we become aware of this unquenchable abundance of endless delighting. Unquenchable abundance of endless delighting. Wow. Feeling of intrinsic spaciousness, you could say. A feeling of intrinsic spaciousness. Wow. But first, we have to reverse these vows and relinquish them, right? And that's tough work. That's the work in the tomb. You know, you're kind of isolated like a hermit in this tomb, and you're working on it. But, you know, have a little bit of fun with it, but it's tough work. There's no question about it. At times it's brutally tough because these vows are very ingrained. You know, we're so used to them. We think without these vows, we're like, we'll have an abyss. You know, absurdity will disappear. And since we believe absurdity is God, we think a God will disappear. There'll be nothing for us, just an abyss. So we're like nervous, like, is this really true? Is this really absurd? And then sometimes you have an experience where you drop the vows momentarily and you experience this unquenchable abundance of endless delighting. And you say, wow, this is it. And then you get the jitters, like, well, how did I do that? I don't know. And then you gradually go back to the vows. They come back on you. The vows come back on you. And then you got to, you know, keep going to work. So it's hard work. It's hard work. But it's doable work. Now, we're into Zone 4 takeover of this world, which is a blackout of the realization that there are many, many who have done this work. Christianity has many who have gotten free of death, actually. Most people don't know that, right? That's already been blacked out to a huge extent. Used to be Christians are aware that there was many, many Christian saints that actually did this work, Christian mystics, and got free of death. Many. Now, most people can't name even one. Okay, that's how bad the blackout has been. And in other traditions, there have also been very, very many. Like, for instance, all the great traditions have had many, many, many get free of death, actually. Many. That's being blacked out also. So the more you black out rewrite history, I mean, the Zone 4 people, I've said they're going to rewrite history. They say history is a bunch of lies. We're going to rewrite it. No, you know what they're going to do? They're going to write out the history of all those previously who have succeeded at going into this subconscious death vow area and reversing and relinquishing these death vows and then entering into this wonderful, unquenchable abundance of endless delighting. They're going to write that out of history. They're going to write out how they did it, all of that stuff. Get rid of it. Get rid of it. Like I said, there's going to be a massive revisionism of history going at the end. By 2030, you will have this new history that kids will be taught. Now, we're talking about these kids who are going to be taught by 2030. Let's trace the generations. Earlier in this last 100 years, you started out with, like, well, let's take the greatest generation. That's the ones that were involved in World War II. Let's call it the greatest generation. After them, they had the silent generation, which was like up to 1945. Then you had the boomers, you know, from 46 to 65, let's say, the boomer generation. Then you've had the Gen X's, then you had the millennials starting like 1976 millennials, and then you have the, you know, Gen Xers around 2000, 1999, year 2000. Some say 1996 for the Gen Zs, the Gen Zs. If you trace this back, if you look back, you got the boomers had their children, okay, who were millennials. The millennials, a lot of millennials had kids who are now Gen Zers, okay? And Gen Zers are going to have kids by the time 2030 comes along. And those kids in 2030 are going to be taught a different history of this planet, okay? Different history. Now, and that history is going to black out the most important part of history, which is so many, 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 many have gotten free of death through doing this right psychological work, okay, of getting... They're going to black all that important stuff out. And the kids who are going to be born into from 2030 on are going to be utterly propagandized with this Zone 4 propaganda to believe that focusing on material abundance is God's plan for, is the plan for us, is the universe's plan for us, they'll call it. That's the universe's plan for us, focusing on material abundance, which is entirely wrong, entirely mistaken. So how did we get there? You know, you're thinking, how did we get there? How did, you know, how is this possible? I know a lot of people like right now are in shock, right? I mean, what's going on in this world? A lot of people, a majority of people on this planet are realizing something here is really screwy, okay, going on. It is. It's very screwy. More so than we realize, we are going toward a point by 2030 where they're going to rewrite history and write out all the important parts for us, okay? So, you know, like, how did this happen? Well, it happened intentionally by scripting it and working on it. So, without criticizing anyone in particular or feeling anyone's being targeted by this, I'm not trying to target anyone, we're inviting everybody into this promise of Jesus that we can get into that deep subconscious area where our vows, death vows are, and reverse those death vows and relinquish them, right? And I'm doing it, and I've been told I'm going to be successful at it. And others, many have done it throughout history, and I'm aware of that fact. I certainly won't be the first one, okay? Let's put it that way. Not at all. Not at all. Now, we have these... The silent generation was still focused on these death vows. We can do this. They were still focused on the importance of that. The boomers came along. What happened with the boomers? Starting in, let's say, 1946. We'll call that the boomers. Start of the boomer time. So some, the oldest boomers would be like 74, basically, this year will be like 74. What the boomers did is they started the ball rolling towards the year 2030, this 2030 agenda of revisionism. They started the ball rolling, actually. And what they did, what were the boomers? It was the drug generation, okay? Drug generation. I lived through it, okay? I know the scenario extremely well. And what happened was the boomers took drugs like crazy, okay? They were gobbling every type of drug they could find. And a lot of them took amphetamines. And these drugs gave you simulated spiritual experiences, especially like amphetamines and psychogenic drugs also. Heroin, I mean, the boomers just gobbled everything you could think of. They were huge drug users. And these drugs give you these false type of experiences that make you feel that you've had some huge spiritual breakthrough. Okay, that you've already had the breakthrough. Like, yeah, I've got it. I don't need to go into that storehouse and work on these vows. I could just take a drug and that does it for me. It does it for me, okay? So what happened was, during the boomers' rise to power, there's so many people who took drugs, and most of the leadership of the boomer generation used drugs. A very high percentage of them heavily used drugs. If you didn't use drugs, you were not hip, okay? You were not hip. You were not part of the leadership cartel of the boomers. And the boomers said, look, we understand spirituality. We've got it. We've got it. And we'll show you how to do it. The only problem is they forgot about the tough, hard work that's required to psychologically go into deep subconscious dungeon where all our death vows are, and to work and clear that out, reverse and relinquish all those death vows. Well, they forgot about that. Why? Because they're taking amphetamines and feeling like Superwoman and Superman. See, amphetamines give you this fake spiritual messiah trip. They really do. They really, really do. And so the leadership of the boomers, the boomer generation, they thought they had found a really great shortcut to happiness, which was drugs. And they said, no, it's not the drugs, it's the spiritual experiences that I'm having on the drugs. Well, that's called amphetamine psychosis, actually. Well, it's the high of amphetamines. And then the psychosis is that you're the Messiah and you've got it. Okay, so then that was the beginning of these troubles. Then the boomers had children, which are what, Gen X and millennials, right? So if you're like a 1940, let's say 1950 for a boomer, let's say 1950, you start having kids in 1970, let's say, 70 to 75, but maybe a little later. So the kids, Gen Xers, you know, there, and then after 75 would be millennials. So the Gen Xers and the millennials, Gen Xers are like from 65 to 75, and then millennials are from 76 to 95, basically. Those are the children of boomers, and the boomers raise their children to believe that drugs, there's a way, you know, there's a shortcut. We don't have to do this hard work, discipline, tough, you know, spiritual work. You know, there's, you know, you can enjoy, you know, material abundance. You can have it all. And drugs are great. Drugs are so helpful. You all get sex, drugs, rock and roll. That stuff's really going to save you. So they raised this generation of children to believe that. So these, their children, they didn't believe in Jesus' way that he is risen, of actually doing the really, really difficult, tough work that's necessary. Oh, no, 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 no. They just had to, you know, let's just party. You know, it's like, yeah, my parents, like, they're really spiritual, you know. They didn't do that stuff. They just love taking drugs and partying and stuff. They're really spiritual. They could talk all this talk. Oh, yeah, I was floating on this. I was floating on that. You're floating on drugs. And so then the, let's say, a millennial, 1980 millennial, has kids and they're 20. Year 2000 would be, their kids would be born around year 2000. So their kids, the children of boomers, their children are now Gen Zers. So the Gen Zers are now the third generation of this belief, like, hey, you know, we're awesome. We've got it. Now all we have to do is make this world perfect and woo! You know, we'll really have a blast here. And they don't have a clue about what it's really about. And so then the Gen Zers are going to have kids starting, the Gen Z kids are going to start in basically the year 2030. And that'll be the fourth generation, okay? And the fourth generation will be oblivious of the real tradition of how it's actually done. And then they will just have this revisionist history given to them where nobody's ever done it that way. And that was just, that's just mythology. That's my crazy mythology of like these ancient idiots, you know. But we are really like dialed in, like, you know, to biotech. Yeah, that's the answer. Biotech is the answer. So the boomers started the whole biotech thing. They're really the ones that really pushed it. Their children are pushing it now. The millennials are pushing it intensely, right? In the world, the millennials are taking over and they're pushing biotech intensely. And then Gen Zers are also pushing it very intensely. And then their children will be raised on in a zone four way of extreme materialism. Extreme materialism, not being aware of what's really going on deep, deep down in that dungeon, that death-vowing dungeon. And having the will and the encouragement to go down there and clean it out. Okay? They won't have that. So, bummer, as the boomers used to love to say. Big bummer. Yeah, a real bummer. Real bummer. Real bad trip, boomers. Real bad trip. Not singling out any boomers. I'm talking to the wise. I'm a boomer myself, but I was wise to the hipness of the boomers. I was wise to it. I got wise to it. I said, hey, you know, I didn't like it. I don't like the boomers. I didn't like it. I said, these guys are on a power trip. Boomers, they're on a power trip. They're faking their spirituality. They're seizing power and control of the world. And they're trying to make a physical, materialistic utopia here. You know, so I do not get along that great with boomers. Nor with any generation. Because the ones more like the silent generation, I get along a little better with them. But they have a hard time, you know, anyway, yeah, I don't know too many. I do respect what the silent generation did. That they were very intense. They brought us A Course in Miracles, the silent generation. They did. Helen Schuckman, Kenneth Wapnick, William Tetford. Those people, You know, they're very intellectual, those people, very intellectual. But they were very much into psychology. They were very intensely working on psychology. So they were into the realization that there's a psychological job we have to do, the silent generation. So they brought us a lot of great teaching out of that generation. Greatest generation, silent generation, they were still into really sophisticated psychology. I was born, and when I grew up, getting help from the greatest generation, the silent generation, I was born in 1956. I grew up, I was very sophisticated in psychology. That's what I studied. That was my major. I was very, very attuned into psychology because that I grew up in that type of environment. So, you know, that sophistication is gone in this world. It is gone. I mean, we've got Super Mario Brothers now, basically. That, you know, doi, 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 doi. You know, that's fight or flight, animalistic stuff. It's not psychological sophistication. So this psychological sophistication is necessary to have the poise to go into that death bow dungeon and clear out those monsters in there. You know, there's some ancient monsters in there, and the monsters are these death vows that we're repeating. Okay, those are the monsters. And if you don't have encouragement and backing and know that it's possible and know the tradition is behind you, and if you know, then you're going to freak out. You're going to freak out and just say, forget it. Let me take some drug. You know, let me take ecstasy, DMT. There's all these drugs that simulate spirituality that the biochemists are working on. Say, that's all you need. Here, you got trouble, psychotherapy, sure, take DMT or DMST or whatever. You know, there's always these new drugs coming out. And the kids say, I don't have to do this hard work. They'll come up with some drugs. Yeah, that's what they say. I don't have to do this hard work. That's stupid. That's for old people. We got a faster way. We'll just take these drugs. That'll do it for us. No, it won't. That'll create this unawareness of these death vows, which then put you on a track to a physical, materialistic utopia, which will never feel suitable for you. Our unquenchable abundance of endless delighting is of essence and idea. It's an essencing. It's an essencing. It's a formless essencing, which this material world can never even approximate, actually. It's indescribable in materialistic terms. It's indescribable in materialistic terms. So there's no way we can ever make a materialistic utopia feel suitable for us. No way. And we will end up with massive, those people end up with massive mental illness is what will happen. And of course they say, well, we're not worried about that because we'll have drugs for that too. We got that covered too. that's the Gen Zers word. We got that. Don't worry about that mental illness thing. We got that covered too. No, they don't. They don't have it covered. And those who go into that will find that out. They'll say, you know, we got everything covered, but I still feel like this vague unsuitability, like I'm uncomfortable. You know, that's the Gen Zers. I feel uncomfortable. You're making me feel uncomfortable. They feel uncomfortable about everything. Why? Because they've shut themselves off psychologically from being able to clear out these death vows, and they're going for a physical utopia, and that's making them feel uncomfortable. The more they go towards a physical utopia, the more uncomfortable they feel. It's like, I just want to be around, you know, you're making me feel uncomfortable. That's sort of like really actionable, you know, don't you think? You know, we call them snowflakes because any bit of psychological sophistication makes them melt. Ah! You know, what are you're trying to throw me into an abyss? Because they've shut themselves off psychologically from the real subconscious depths where the work has to be done. This is what's happening. So by the time of 2030, and the kids that in 2040, if we're still around, you know, the kids will really be suffering. You'll find massive mental health problems. We already do have massive mental health problems. A lot of millennials and Gen Zers are maxed out on antidepressants already. I say, hello? Depression means you're avoiding doing the psychological work you're supposed to do. Duh. And so they said, I don't know what you're talking about. You're crazy. You're making me feel uncomfortable. All I need to do is take an antidepressant. I just got to get the right dosage. But there's a new one. My doctor told me, like, I got some really nice ones coming along. And that'll like, take care of the problem. I still have a little bit of uncomfortableness. I don't feel quite comfortable around certain, around people who don't think exactly the way I think and, want to try to make the world perfect. And anyone doesn't want to try to make the world perfect. I want to, like, destroy them, I feel so agitated sometimes and uncomfortable. No! The problem is you're not doing the work you're supposed to do. That's the problem. Relying on drugs to take care of the psychological work you have to do. That's a non-starter. That is a non-starter. That is a non-starter. So I've been through that whole thing. I've been through it all. I went through the whole scenario, so I know it backwards and forwards. And I realized, antidepressants, for instance, that's not a cure. They're just making things worse. So I found A Course in Miracles. I said, boom, this is going to put me in the right direction. This is taking me in the right direction. This is Jesus, and he's showing me this is the right direction. This will work for you. I promise it'll work for you. Just do it. And I said, you're right, I'll do it. Boom, like that. I said, okay, goodbye. Any medicines, forget it. Gradually said, okay, I don't need them. Gradually, weaned off of anything. Because I got depressed when I was young because this death world here says, no, you can't get free of death. You're crazy. I said, yes, I can. When I was young, I said, I'm going to do this. I'm going to get free of death. That's what I told people when I was young, a kid. I said, I'm going to get free of death and I'm going to enter into eternal life. That's what I'm going to do this lifetime for sure. And they said, you are nuts. You got something wrong. You're cuckoo. And so I got really heavily suppressed for that attitude of my confidence. They said, you're overconfident. You're overreaching. I said, no, I'm not. You're going to see there's going to be some great help coming in the world. And of course, I knew A Course in Miracles was coming into the world. There it was, 1978. I was really depressed at the time, really badly suffering psychologically. And then I got that and I said, okay, I'm going to do this. And this is going to clear it up for me. I'm going to get to work now. And so I have been working ever since. Like 41 years of intense work in clearing out, clearing this all out, doing the right psychological work, tough work. No drugs. Okay, drugs are absolutely the wrong way to go. The boomers tried to tell me that was the way. They were so dominating, the boomers, that they crushed me, crushed me down badly. And I felt like, man, if I don't go their way, it's like no way, And finally, A Course in Miracles came along. And I said, hey, this is the way. This is the way. Meaning, here's the psychological sophistication presented to us and showing us you can do this. And then I started remembering, oh, yeah, this is what I came here for, to do this psychological work, right? Psychological work and get it done. And then I started backing away from the boomers. I said, hey, I went into a shell in my room. I didn't have anything more to do with the boomers. I did not. They really led me astray badly, very badly. And basically, I've sort of kept to myself ever since, because the newer generations coming in also are very much astray, very much astray. They don't want to do the tough work. They don't want to do the tough work. They don't want to take their lunch pail to work every day and really, really work hard on it, which you have to do. They think, oh no, computers will do it for us. Sure, why? Well, they'll develop these really great psychoactive, biochemical substances like that. That'll just like, wow, just open us right up, to nirvana. Well, they'll do all sorts of stuff, but they won't free you from these death vows, actually. They won't actually get the job done. They're a substitute for getting the job done. They're a fake way to keep you loyal to this death dream as you're working on trying to fix the world. We got to make this world. We can make this world a beautiful place. When you get free of these death vows, everything is already intrinsically, unquestionably, abundantly, endlessly delightful. There's no question of needing to do something to make it that way. It's already is that way. It could never be any other way. You don't see these great teachers starting some huge work programs to beautify the planet and make the planet a better place. No, they don't do that. They don't do that. They say, wake up from this death dream and you will find everything is endlessly, unquenchably, abundantly perfect, delightfully perfect. just as it is, just as it is. Okay. Yes. And you certainly will not be interested in continuing to struggle with materiality and all this stuff. You will realize your real home is essence, formless essence. So you're not going to try to create a physical materialistic utopia here. That's not the point of it all. The point of it is a humble, lowly, humble life without trying to maintain some super intricate, massive technological infrastructure. Just a humble, simple life in your little hut where you're just focusing on going within and working on this, just opting out of I, 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 just opting out of I and opting into now, opting out of I, opting out of I, just opting out of I and opting into now, opting out of I, opting out of I, just opting out of I and opting into now, just opting out of I, just opting out of I, opting out of I and opting into now, opting out of I, opting out of I, just opting out of I and opting into now, opting out of I, opting out of I, just opting into, just opting out of I and opting into now, opting out of I, opting out of I, just opting out of I and opting into now, opting out of I, opting out of I, just opting out of I and opting into now, opting out of I, opting out of I, just opting out of I and opting into now, opting out of, just opting out of I, just opting out of I, just opting out of I and opting into now. I is an anomaly and now is now. I is an anomaly and now is now. I is an anomaly and now is now. I is an anomaly, now is now. Like that. Impossible is impossible right now, wow. 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 So this like sheds light into this darkness, some deep, deep dungeon of death-vowing darkness that we have within us. It's shedding light in there. Impossible is impossible right now. Wow. 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 Now, if this practicing was not necessary, Jesus would not have given us this workbook of 365 lessons, an intense workbook. I don't do those practices much. Because I'm so caught up in the theory of ACIM that for some reason I didn't click into those practices that well. I could do it, but there's other styles of practicing that also work. But he gave us 365 one practice for every day. And he said, you have to practice like this in some way. He said, this is just one course. There are many, many ways to do this. Here is a way. But you have to do this practicing, and you have to succeed with this practicing. And so he made it very clear that practice is essential. Very clear that this tough practicing is essential. So he didn't say drugs are the way. He saved us from the boomers, the millennials, the Gen Zers, and the Gen 230ers, you know. What would we call that? The Corona generation or something? I don't know. No, it's the blackout generation. Gen blackout. Gen revision. Gen revision. I don't know. What do you want to call them? Maybe some have some idea, you know. But no, Jesus said you have to do these tough practices. Otherwise, you won't succeed. Otherwise, you won't succeed. You have to get in. You have to love practicing. You have to love it so much that that's what you do. So opting out of I, opting out of I, just opting out of I and opting into now. I is an anomaly and now is now. Opting out of I, just opting out of I and opting into now. I is an anomaly and anomaly is wow. I is anomaly, anomaly is wow. I is anomaly, and anomaly is wow. I is anomaly, and anomaly is wow. I is anomaly, and anomaly is wow. So all of these techniques, you know, I developed these techniques so I'm able to keep my poise as I'm working on these deep death vows. And there's a technique to keeping your poise. At first, you won't feel much poise, and when you do it, you won't. That's okay. That's expected. You're going to fall off like, whoa, you know, what was that? Holy cow. That's scary. It's like working on a balance pipe. Psychologically, it's very helpful to work on a balance pipe. It's similar because, you know, you're first like all jittery and you're falling. And as you keep working on it, eventually it's like, you just feel like, ah, oh, this is like, I can do this. It's not a problem. I don't got the jitters. You settle down and do it. But if you don't have the technique to keep your poise, it is going to get to you. So you have to ultimately develop these techniques to keep your poise as you're doing this tough, tough work. Otherwise, it will be too difficult. Honestly, it will be too difficult. If I didn't develop these techniques and get really good at them, it would be too difficult, no question. I tried to do it without these techniques, too difficult. And then that's where the drug pushers come in and say, hey, you know, we've got something that'll help you get past that difficulty, you know. BS, you know, the big lie, the big drug lie. There were so many drug pushers when I grew up, boomer drug pushers, they were everywhere. The whole world was flooded with these people. And they're just looking like, you know, predators to see if you're having psychological problems, and then they'd zoom in on you. Say, and these drug pushers usually worked in tandem. It was usually male and female. They always worked together, male and female. And the female would always come on as the good, you know, good cop, you know, bad cop. The female would come on as a good cop, like, you know, oh, I can see you're suffering. You just need some companionship, you know. You're just not finding the right woman, maybe. You're not finding the right relationships. I understand. Yeah, I understand. Really, yeah, probably. Oh, the real sympathetic, sexy, loving woman would come on to you. And then she'd make you think that she's interested in relationship with you. And then she'd introduce you and say, oh, I got a friend. She'd say, I got this friend. You got to meet this friend because he's like been really helpful to me. I used to have the problems you had, but I've really got over those problems. I'm feeling really, really great. I mean, and then these women were like really vibrant, you know. It's like, wow. How could I be that vibrant? And she's interested in me. Well, she has a friend. Well, this friend happens to have these drugs. She says, oh, yeah, I can get you some of those. She says, I took these drugs, and they really helped me out. Really. So then she gets you to party. She gets you all drugs. She gets you your vulnerability, real feeling like reckless and daring. Gets you to take drugs. You feel like, wow, what was that? You know, it's like, oh, my problems kind of disappeared for a while. And they think, wow. And then now you're starting to get interested in drugs. They hook you on drugs, get a drug habit, and then she's on to the next one. She's on to many. She's doing this all the time with all these different guys, this woman, getting her hooked into the pusher guy who has the connections to get the drugs. That was all over the place. All over the place back then. Terrible, isn't it? Yeah, they worked in teams. They worked in teams. The woman was the front person. Keep that in mind. Keep that in mind. Don't be taken in by these vibrant women, you know, okay? A lot of them using amphetamines. Amphetamines made them feel like superwomen. They're so witty and clever and energetic and vibrant and confident, you know, and loving. Like, they think, like, I've got the secret to the universe, you know. Oh, yeah. And you can have it too, and they're interested in you. No, they're interested in making sure that they keep getting drugs. So they hook these new people in, clients into the drug pusher. So the drug pusher makes more money, okay? And so the payment to the woman from the drug pusher is free drugs, okay? Free drugs, a free place, free room, free board, free drugs, okay? They're working as a team there, working as a team. And then the woman later blames the man for it all, right? Which isn't true. They were working together because they were both getting this power trip. They're both on this ego power trip. Like, I'm, look, everybody loves me. I can, everybody turns to me for help. Like, I'm the goddess, you know, it's a goddess trip. So many boomer women went on a goddess trip, actually, and are continuing to do so. Gen X, millennials, Gen Z, so many women are going on goddess trips, and so many men are going on these, you know, assisting the goddess trip, you know, like partners on this, you know, goddess tripping thing, right? Like godding trip and a goddessing trip, and it's revolving around drugs and doing everything other than what you're supposed to be doing. Okay, everything other than what you're supposed to be doing, which is pretty much leading a low-key life, spending lots of time in intense meditation, contemplation, doing the five steps that we pointed out, which is how to block panic, which how to maintain your poise when you go into this death dungeon, this dungeon of death vows. You have to maintain your poise. Maintain your poise, work on right theory so you know why you're doing this. It's not in vain. You're doing it because you know you have to do it, okay? This death dreaming is futile. You know, you realize the futility of this death dreaming. That's theory. Then right practice. You say, okay, I'm forgiving myself and relinquishing the vow of opting in, into I and opting out of now. I'm relinquishing those death vows. I forgive myself and relinquish my vows of opting into death and opting out of now. Okay? So you start your, you have your practice purpose. Okay? I know the theory why I have to do this, and now I know I can forgive myself and relinquish these vows. I'm telling myself this is possible, and then you're practicing, and then you get into advanced practicing of dealing with these death vows, which is the fourth step, like opting out of I and opting into now. I is an anomaly, and now is now. I is an anomaly, and anomaly is wow. Opting out of I and opting into now. I is an anomaly, and anomaly is wow. I is an anomaly, and now is now. I is an anomaly, and anomaly is wow. I is an anomaly, and now is now. I is an anomaly, and anomaly is wow. Opting out of I, and opting into now. I is an anomaly, and now is now. I is an anomaly, and anomaly is wow. Okay? That's advanced practicing. That's advanced practicing. It's very powerful and effective. Then from there, you start having direct experiencing of getting free of these death vows. And you begin to have experiences now and then of the actual nature of reality. Okay, and these are not based on any drug taking whatsoever. These are genuine. It's genuinely smooth, psychologically smooth. It's not just a fake biochemical euphoric experiencing you're having. It's a smoothing out of your psychology. It's dropping the opting out of the I, and the I just subsides into the smoothness. The whole I complex just subsides effortlessly, simply, quickly, effortlessly, just like that. Just that's it. Gone. The whole I complex gone. Okay, but you're just calm, smooth, calm, right? So that's genuine success, not drug-induced euphorias of any type. We're not trying to manipulate the biochemistry or anything like that. We're doing it the genuine way that actually works. So this is what Easter's for, that Jesus said, what I did, you can do also. I resurrected from the dead. You think that I'm subject to death forever? No. You're not subject to death forever. I'm showing you, you're not subject to death. It's a dream. You can relinquish your vows to keep dreaming this way. And if you do the practices that I told you, Jesus gave out a tremendous amount of practices to the mystic community of those times. And they were symbolized in all sorts of artistic symbology and symbols. Those were actual reminders of how to practice the right way. He gave those out to his closest disciples, those who understood it. So there's a mystical tradition of Christianity that knows how to practice properly. And all that Christian artwork and stuff, that's all symbolic. That if you know how to read the symbology of it, it clues you into right psychological practicing is what it actually does. So there are Christian mystics who understand that just to more or less, you know, more or less. And throughout history, Christians understood that. The iconography of the whole thing was like a very sumptuous, you know, presentation of psychologically what is our duty, responsibility, how can we get this job done that Jesus said we could do? How can we get it done? How can we get this done? And so Christians have been trying to focus on this for thousands of years. How do we get this done? How do we get this done? And so Jesus came back psychologically, said, look, you need some help right now because there's some big, big problems coming up in the world. And you really got to ground yourself in how to do this properly right now. Otherwise, you know, whew, look out. Too much trouble. And so Johnny on the Spot came along at the right time. Certainly, I was able to get with this in time, fortunately. And now the troubles are indeed upon us. Speaking of the troubles that we have now, the corona troubles, the corona times we're in, the fear plandemic, you might say. How much do we want to get into this is the question. See, that's kind of like, how intense do we want to get into this, actually? But have to assess this, you know. I don't want to lose the momentum of the video and by getting into this too intensely, because people will jump on this and say, yeah, you know, this is interesting. It's conspiracy and all this stuff. Yeah. These are certainly the times of trouble. It is certainly the transitioning period right now. And what you have now, the founders of the U.S. Constitution and that we've been living under in the United States, they understood that, they looked through it back in history, and they said, you know what, the problem really is, historically, is in a governance of this world, what we have to avoid is the bureaucrats taking over. Okay, that's when it goes bad. When the bureaucrats get too much power, okay, that's when things get bad. Really bad. They're unelected. So what we wanted to do in the U.S. is make all our civil service, the people who make decisions over our lives, electable. They have to be responsible, held accountable to the electorate, the people. So if you're overreaching in your authority, guess what? You're voted out of office. That's the greatness of the American system of democracy, is it protects us from the petty bureaucrats seizing power and overreaching that power, and then really bringing countries into hell and ruin by their egos, you know? So here, you're supposed to be able to vote them out of office, and we do all the time. If somebody overreaches, recall, vote them out, whatever, right? We understand that. What we're seeing now is a massive overreach, okay? A massive overreach by bureaucrats we could see it happening. These unelected officials are jumping up and saying, I'm in charge. You know, I'm in charge now. I was born to be in charge. I'm in charge. I'm going to tell you, you can't do anything because I say so. Well, they're not electable. They're not accountable to being elected, these petty bureaucrats, you see? So you have a bureaucratic takeover happening in this world where they just say, this is the way it's going to be, and they have no accountability. It's kind of like the news media. They're not electable. So they can just be as nasty as they want to be, make up all this fake stuff without sources, say with sources, say they don't have any sources. They're not accountable. They're not electable. They're part of this bureaucracy, this whole machinery of bureaucrat. People want to have power here without accountability. They don't want accountability. Like, well, everything I said, what I said to you, I really messed it all up. But there's no accountability. Zero accountability. So you have these generations are coming in now where they don't believe they should be held accountable for anything. And they're fueling this bureaucratic takeover of people simply dictating what your life has to be without us having any say about it at the ballot box. Whereas previously, if you didn't like what the politicians were dictating, guess what? You elected somebody else you like better. That's this great system of governance that we have as democracy. And right now, democracy is being subverted by this bureaucratic takeover of the country, state by state by state by state. Now, there's a lot of resistance to this in the United States, a lot, rightfully so. But you got some governors public health officials that are just saying, you can't do anything. And they're just going, they're overreaching, they're going crazy. People are saying, we need to recall these people and get them out of office. You know, this is also in Canada, okay? Canada's having the same problem as the United States. The whole world's having this problem right now. But the problem is that you've got the millennials, the Gen Xers, the millennials, the boomers, Gen Xers, millennials in power, and they don't like accountability because they're not being accountable to themselves in their own lives, are they? They're not doing this tough psychological work. They've been too busy taking, you know, sex, drugs, and rock and rolling their lives away. And so they don't, they feel like, hey, I'm not, haven't been accountable to myself. Why should anyone hold me accountable? I should just be able to, you know, do whatever the heck I want to do and not be held accountable to it. So I should just be able to dictate to everybody else what their lives have to be, you know, and I shouldn't experience any accountability for that. So you have these generations that have rejected personal accountability in their own psychological, spiritual lives. Now they want to run the world for the rest of us. Okay? So it starts with personal accountability. Are you being responsible for your what you're responsible for? Every great teacher says you're here for one reason. Now they say it in different ways. Realize the self. Get free of, awaken from this dream. You know, get free of death, your death vows. It all amounts to the same. All amounts to the same. You're here just for that reason and for no other reason. No other reason. So you are must hold yourself accountable to accomplishing this, which means you have to be very disciplined, okay? Very disciplined. You have to avoid false shortcuts, you know, false paths that lead you astray. You must be wise. You must be disciplined. You must be hardworking at this. You must be willing to put up with the suffering that it takes, the stress that it takes. You must stick with it. You must be persevering. Okay, all of these virtues that we're taught, that this level three, we're taught these virtues. You say these virtues are essential in order for you to accomplish the task that you must accomplish. And right now, with these last four generations, the last three and the fourth that will come, they've thrown that away. They've thrown that away. Say, no. I'm just here to have fun. I don't need to do all that stuff. If I want to feel good, I know ways to feel good. You know, if I'm feeling kind of lousy, I got a drug for that. Yeah, I don't need to do all that hard work. That's not fun. You're not here for fun. You're not supposed to be here for fun. You're here to relinquish your death vowing. That's what you're here for. And that's more than fun. That's amazing. So I haven't had much fun in my life. I've had no fun in my life, really. But I've had an amazing life. It's beyond fun. It's been intense beyond fun. You know, it's like, wow, I'm confronting these monsters, these psychological monsters, this whole monstrous death belief system. Confronting it all and standing up to it and dealing effectively with it and reversing it and relinquishing it, that's really interesting. That the fun life that the world called me to, like, huh? These people, I said, I've wasted your lives. You totally wasted your life. You know? Yeah. And these people, they celebrate Easter, for instance. You know, they said, yeah, Easter, I really had this loving, gave love to everybody. I'm, you know, I hope the world, I want to make the world a better place. That's what Easter's about. And then what do? After they did that, they say, yeah, I'm really on track. Then they watch CNN for the rest of the, or CNN or Fox or whatever for the rest of the day. You know, any media, you know, it's all the same distraction, actually. Same distraction. It's not really holding yourself accountable to your responsibility, is it? Watching that stuff. Not really. So we don't want to get trapped into that. I know there's, you know, the media is very polarized. So if you're listening to one side, you know, one side's more conservative, is saying, "Look, we, you know, these other people are overreaching." So they are playing to that, but the real factor is: are you doing your psychological practice properly today? We know they're overreaching. Okay, we know that. We don't need to watch the news to know that. Maybe a little bit, but you know, you got some governors here, you got some people, bureaucrats, and even elected officials. They're going to pay for it, you know, but they don't think they will. They don't think they will. They think that this they'll be able to shut down the culture and society, and the younger generations are all for that, you know. They say, look, you know, we got a way around this whole democratic system of accountability, you know, because it's not working. It's not working. They say, we got to fix the world, and this is not working. Well, it's working. It worked to help us do what's essential here. which is to reverse and relinquish all these death vows that we have, which Jesus told us, that's your purpose here. This is what is essential for you. He never called us to anything else. He didn't call us to fix the world in a certain way. He called us to prayer, which it means right psychological practice is what he called us to. Calls all of us to this. Every great teacher has done this. So we're not called to fix the world, so to speak, right? Not primarily, no. We're called to relinquish this death-based dream, this world. Relinquish it. Jesus tells us that if we wanted to fix the environment of this world, he said we could do it instantaneously. Just a simple decision, and it is so. Because this is just a dream. You could fix a dream instantly, can't you? But he says you choose not to, because it's a great excuse to avoid doing the work that you really need to do. It's a great excuse to say, climate change is going to destroy us in 10 years. We got to work on that. That's a great excuse to avoid doing the psychological work that you actually need to do. Great, right? People are using it as an excuse is what they're doing. So this, you know, what's the remedy for this corona madness? I call it the blackout. Okay, I've been calling it this for quite a while. It's the blackout. 10-year blackout phase. They're going to black out our awareness of what our real purpose is here. Rewrite history and raise children on this revisionist history. And along the way, there may be quite a bit of collateral damage that they may inflict, actually, as they are headed in this direction. They're headed in this direction. You're not going to head them off. You're not going to just reverse, you know, the whole scripting and purpose of all these people's lives that are here in this world. So many, you're not going to just say stop, and they're just going to say, oh, okay. You know, if that was so, then any, you know, perfect teacher could come into this world and just stop everybody in their tracks. That's never happened. It's never happened at all. We have free will. Every single one of us has absolute freedom. We're free to continue to dream that this death vow dream. We're free to do so and pursue that. And many are choosing to do that. It doesn't work. It'll be futile. It'll be dystopia. It'll be nightmarish. It'll result in massive, severe mental illness. But they think they're so clever that they think, oh, no, it's going to work for us. Yes, but we know otherwise. And the mental illnesses that come are horrible, horrible, horrible. I've been through them. I know the whole gamut of the whole thing. Horrible stuff. You feel like you're stuck in some sort of endless unsuitability, and there's nothing you can do about it. That's how you feel. Imagine that. How you feel like you just have lost all hope, but there's no hope. And there's nothing you can do about it, unless maybe there's a drug somewhere that'll help me. But you feel like you're never going to get out of this. Never. That's because these death vows, you're vowing to never quit this death dreaming until you succeed. And you're feeling that it doesn't succeed, and yet you feel that it'll go on forever. That's because of these subconscious vows that you have. So you got to go and face these vows, face them down, and develop the poise and the strength and the confidence and get the help from these great teachers who have helped me so much, encouraging me, saying, you're doing it, you're doing it, you're doing it, you're doing it. Just keep on doing it. You're going to succeed. Ram Maharshi told me, you are going to succeed. I already see it. I see your future. You're going to succeed at this. So don't stop. Keep doing it, what you're doing. Keep working at it. That was in like the year 2000, Ram Maharshi came to me in a dream and told me, don't quit. I was ready to quit. And he says, no, don't quit. You're going to succeed. Don't quit. You're a winner. You're going to succeed at this. I already know. It's already done deal. Just keep working at it. You're going to get there. And that really, you know, saved me. That saved me. It's just an example of a great teacher saving you on this path. They'll step in and save you. If you're ready to quit, someone will step in and save you. That happened. It's happened to me a number of times. First with Jesus in 1978. Ananda Maima stepped in 1997. Ram Maharshi, the year 2000. Buddha Longchenpa stepped in the year 2013. All of these teachers stepped in when I was stalled out and ready to quit. And they said, no. You're a winner. You're going to succeed. Don't stop. I've got your back. I'll help you. Don't worry. You've got this. Or we've got this. They said, basically, we've got this. Okay. And made all the difference. You know, it like sort of refired my confidence, like, yeah, I can do this. I can do this. But it's not so easy to get these ancient vows reversed and relinquished. It is not so easy. You will feel at times like, you know, it's too difficult. You feel like quitting. There's no question about that. And but these teachers will step in. They'll subconsciously, they'll appear to you in dreams or some way, they'll step in and say, no, I got your back. I got your back all the way through. I got your back. Well, you know, I'm not going to leave you. I'm not going to forsake you. I'm there. I'm encouraging you. If there's some big trouble, I'll move it out of the way for you. They don't move everything out of the way, but if there's something really, really bad, they will move it out of the way. They will move it out of the way. They have ways to do that. They do. They can re-script. They could re-script things in certain ways to so it doesn't become impossible. You know, you don't sink. You don't drown in the difficulty of it. You don't drown in the difficulty of it. So if these turmoil times get too difficult for us, these teachers are going to, those who are working with these, you know, on this responsibility, and they know who you are. You are known. When you're working on this, you are known. No question about it. They will pull us out of the trouble. There's no question about that. If it gets too difficult. Okay, so don't worry. Don't think like, oh, it's going to become too difficult. If it does, we will be pulled out of the trouble. They will not let us sink. They do not allow those who are being really responsible to quit, to sink back into this insanity, this madness, this death vowing, and then go back into this hideous mental health problems. And they're not going to allow that to happen. If you tell them, I don't want to sink, they won't let you sink. And whatever it takes to prevent you from sinking, they will do it. They will do it. And it could be quite drastic at this time. There's nothing they cannot do. Okay, it's a dream. They can re-script things in any which way to prevent you from sinking, from prevent us from sinking. So just keep doing your best. Keep working on this, okay? And I'm helping you, encouraging you, showing you it's possible. I know, like, when I'm looking at dance videos, like, I see these people dancing, and they're so good, I just say, like, there's no way I could do that. No way! And they say, well, just start with this, you know? And so, but I could see it's possible. I say, how are they doing that, you know? They're like, you know, they're 20. That's how they're doing it. They worked at it. They worked at it for years, you know, and they're so coordinated, and they're floating around. I'm saying, wow, you know, wow, that's amazing how you're dancing like that. But I know it's possible. It's possible. And so I'm just like doing this, like little things, like a little breaking down, just real rudimentary things, you know, but I say, oh, I can see some progress. I can see a little bit of progress here and there. So it's like that. At least if you can see it's possible, you say, wow, it is possible to do this. But how do I get that poise? Well, that's where you have to work on it. Those who dance so nicely, what do they look like? They're so poised. They're so poised, like they're just floating on air. They have this balance and poise, and they know the steps. It's like automatic for them almost, right? But it's still not that easy for them, okay? They're still working at it. They're still working at it. But they just, you know, got the poise and the coordination and the timing, and they've worked at it. But psychologically, you can get the poise, you can get the timing, you can get the feeling like, I can do this. I can really, really accustom myself to not having these death vows anymore. Not having these death vows anymore. First, we have forgiveness vows. Okay. And ultimately, we don't even need any vows at all to be what we actually are, right? We don't need vows. We don't have to say, I vow to experience reality, and if we don't do those vows, there's no experiencing of reality. God did not create us like, say, you know, if you don't do vows all the time, you're going to lose this experiencing. No, it's effortless. Reality is our natural, effortless home. Ultimately, we don't need any vows to experience reality, but the intermediate step is to take these death vows and reverse them into forgiveness vows. Reverse these vows. No more death vows, but we still have what we'd say forgiveness vows, which enable us to experience this delightful spaciousness, yes, even while we're still here in this world, when we're still here. And ultimately, we will not even need any vows at all. We'll just be inging, issing, essencing, delight, essencing, issing. unquenchably abundancing, unquenchably abundancing, endlessly delighting, ising, essencing. Wow. Okay, you can't even describe it. Ultimately, we won't have any need for any vows at all. But in the meantime, we want to reverse these death vows into forgiveness vows. Into forgiveness vows. Now, the greatest friends we have in the world are those who help us get into practicing. Because that's the hardest thing to do, is to actually face these death vows and say, okay, I got to start working on this. And I got to do it. You can't do it just theoretically. You can't do it theoretically. These are vows. We are constantly making these death vows to ourselves. This isn't just theory. This is intense vows. We're saying, I vow to never quit until I succeed. I vow to never quit. I vow to keep this death dream going until we are making these vows constantly in our subconscious mind. So this isn't theory. These are intense vows you're dealing with. So you can't just say, well, theoretically, this isn't right. You know, they're not, the vows don't care what you say theoretically. They're going to keep doing it, these vows. So you have to go in there and reverse these vows. Say, hey, you know, just opting out of I. Opting out of I, opting out of I, just opting out of I, opting in the now. Just opting out of I, opting out of I, just opting out of I, and opting in the now. Just opting out of I, opting out of I, just opting out of I, and opting in the now. Just opting out of I, opting out of I, just opting out of I, and opting in the now. Just opting out of I, opting out of I, just opting out of I, and opting in the now. Just opting out of I, opting out of I, just opting out of I, and opting in the now. Opting in the now, opting in the now, opting in the now, just opting in the now. Just opting in the now, opting in the now, just opting in the now, and opting out of I, just opting in the now, opting in the now, just opting in the now, and opting out of I, just opting in the now, opting in the now, just opting in the now, and opting out of I, just opting in the now, just opting in the now, just opting in the now, and opting out of I, just opting out of now, just opting out of now, just opting out of now, just opting out of I, just opting out of now, opting out of now, just opting out of now, and opting out of I, just opting out of now, opting out of now, just opting out of now, and opting out of I, just opting out of now, opting out of now, just opting out of now, and opting out of I, just opting out of now, opting out of now, just opting out of now, and opting out of I. So now I'm doing these kind of fast. You don't have to do them that fast. It's a video, so I'm condensing it. You know, I'm doing it fast. I don't do it that fast normally. I would say, like, just opting into now, opting out of I. So I usually do it about, you know, slower speed. But yeah, just opting into now. You can do it even much slower if you want to. Whatever speed you want is fine. Whatever speed. I do it different speeds. I enjoy all the different speeds. Sometimes I want to do it fast. Sometimes slow. Whatever speed you want to do is fine. Whatever you feel comfortable with, and any, depending on how you feel right now. Just opting into now. And opting out of I. So everybody's different. You could do it really super slow if you want. Yeah, right? Okay. So we all have a little bit of uniqueness to how we practice. So the speed is something that you can do it how you feel it's best for you. Just opting out of now. Just opting into now. Opting into now, just opting into now, and opting out of I. Just opting into now, opting into now, just opting into now, and opting out of I. So what's important to realize, a lot of people do it slowly, okay, slowly. What's important to realize is if you feel like doing it faster, that's also okay. Very few people do it fast, do a fast sort of tempo. You don't hear that. Usually teachers are because they're teaching, you know, beginning poise, they go real slow. But real slow is not the only way to do it. So you shouldn't feel wrong if you feel like kind of doing an up-tempo way. There's also up-temponess. Up-temponess is okay. It's okay. Both are okay. You know, sometimes we like slow songs. Sometimes we like up-tempo songs, right? So just opting out of it. And yeah, so don't feel wrong either way. And don't put a trip on somebody else who does it up-tempo or down-tempo. Just do what you feel is best for yourself. How you feel about it. Just opting into now. Just opting into now. Just opting into now and opting out of I. Just opting into now. Just opting into now. Just opting into now and opting out of I. Wow. I is an anomaly and now is now. I is an anomaly. And now is now. I is an anomaly, and anomaly is wow. I is an anomaly, and anomaly is wow. Wow is anomaly, and wow is wow. Wow is anomaly, and wow is wow. Wow is anomaly, and anomaly is wow. Wow is anomaly, and wow is wow. Wow is anomaly, and wow is wow. Wow is anomaly, and wow is wow. Just opting into now, opting into now, just opting into now and not opting out of I. I is anomaly and anomaly is wow. Anomaly is wow and wow is wow. So all these practices are helping reverse these death vows and help you keep your poise while you're doing it. And the saying that the anomaly is wow, this helps us dismiss all panic, dismiss from going back into these death vows. We say, no, these death vows are just an anomaly. Okay, you get that? These death vows are just an anomaly. Just an anomaly. I don't need, they're not part of my intrinsic spacious delighting experiencing. It's just this artifact, weird anomaly. Nothing to see there. It's just wow. Nothing to see there. It's just wow. Nothing to see there. It's just wow. So this helps us keep the relinquishing there so the old death vows don't come back on us, because they will try to come back on us again and again and again and again. It's really frustrating. And this is why you may think, well, this should be easy. Well, theoretically it's easy, except that we're so habituated to this death vowing, it keeps coming back on us. So it's been come back on me thousands and thousands of times. It's very frustrating, you know. It keeps coming back on you. And this is to be expected. It's normal. Don't expect it just going to vanish forever. It may lay low for a little while and then come back on you. So we're training ourselves to say, this is just an anomaly. An anomaly is just wow. That's all it is. So we cut elaboration out. We don't want to say it's an anomaly, but what kind of anomaly is it? Let me study this anomaly. Then you're getting sucked right back into it. That's the death grip getting its grip back on you. So we have to avoid that death vow grip coming sneaking back and getting a hold of us. We say, I know exactly what this is. That's just an anomaly. An anomaly is just wow. That's all it is. It's wow. Dismissed. Anomaly dismissed. We've labeled it. We've defined it. We've identified it. We've reacted to it. It's just wow. Done. It's just wow. Done. Okay. So those who have successfully reversed all these death vows and relinquished them, they certainly developed savvy and know-how, and it was passed on to their devotees, the other ones who would do it, their students. They passed on this know-how, and this know-how is in danger of being wiped out during this blackout. Wiped out. People won't have the know-how. It's very important to have this know-how. It's extremely important to have it. And so somehow I've been able to revive this, resurrect this know-how by just tremendous dedication and inner guru, you know, revealing this to me. And I realized that others in other times have had the same know-how. I realized they've had that know-how. They know how to use a single word to block it coming back. You know, just use one concept, one word, and then relinquish that word. Ram Maharshi, that's his main technique. So this is the key technique to do. Yeah. It's so, you. But what it is, it's defining this entire system of death vowing as just an anomaly of our experiencing of delighting experiencing of spaciousing. Wow, it's just this silly anomaly. That's all it is. All it is. So just label it. Just give it. It doesn't deserve anything than just one thought. All it deserves, anomaly only deserves one label, one definition, one thought. We say it's just wow. Wow is this very abstract word which could really stand for anything at all. It's just wow, and we're done with it. It's just wow, and we're done. Wow, and we're done. Anomaly, wow, we're done. Anomaly, wow, we're done. 1, 2, 3. It's anomaly, wow, we're done with it. Anomaly, wow, we're done with it. So this is a very, very sophisticated technique and successful technique that's been used throughout history, actually, by those who have succeeded. And theoretically, I see why, why is it so important? It's so important. You cannot get into starting to categorize this death vowing, categorizing. Okay, let me, start studying and judging and categorizing. No, it's just a silly anomaly, wow, done, dismissed. It's anomaly, oh yeah, it's wow, dismissed. Anomaly, wow, dismissed. Anomaly, wow, dismissed. Anomaly, wow, dismissed. Okay, this is very crucial to at least be aware that this technique has to be used. Otherwise, it will keep coming back on you. And you'll eventually just give up. You'll say, oh, this is too difficult for me. It's terrible. I'm never going to succeed. But if you know that there's a way to ultimately prevent it from coming back on you, it's a shortcut, you might say. So you won't have to be practicing forever. I don't want to practice forever. I'm tired of practicing. I want success. But this stuff keeps trying to come back on me, So say, wow, okay, no, just it's an anomaly, what it's wow, dismissed. Anomaly, wow, dismissed. Anomaly, wow, dismissed. Don't give it a second thought. You say, oh, this is an anomaly. Okay, it's wow. I know what it is, exactly what it is. It's wow, gone. No more. Don't need it. That's it. Done with you. So again, I emphasize this practice, this wow practice. It's super essential to ground yourself in the wow practice of doing this to ultimately keep your encouragement going that you can succeed. Otherwise, you will get discouraged. You'll get discouraged because the death vows just keep, the slime keeps coming back on you, pulling you under. Just like, oh no, I'm back to time worshiping. I'm getting into time worshiping, and you say, I don't want to do this. That's horrible. I've been there, done that. I'm done with this time worshiping. But it keeps coming back on me. Okay. You've got to practice, keep your poise, and practice in a way which is putting the brakes on this. Oh, time worship, it's an anomaly coming back. Not time worship, it's an anomaly, which is, I know it's wow, it's the wow anomaly, dismissed. 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 Okay, wow anomaly, dismissed. So that's why we practice, say, I is the anomaly, now is now, I is the anomaly, and anomaly is wow, anomaly is wow, and wow is wow, anomaly is wow, and wow is wow, anomaly is wow, and wow. So I is the anomaly is wow, and wow is wow. I is an anomaly, wow, anomaly is wow, and wow is wow. That's a three-step to get to practicing. I is an anomaly is wow, and wow is wow. So anomaly, wow, dismissed. Right away. You don't say this, oh, what is this I? Start thinking about it. No, you don't think about it. We don't think about it. We dismiss it. But to dismiss it, you need to first identify it. So, oh, it's an anomaly. It's not caused by anything. It's just this crazy anomaly. It's just an anomaly. I know that that's part of my forgiveness practice, is there will be this anomaly. Okay, fine. It's an anomaly. I know what the anomaly is. It's wow. I've labeled it, defined it, and now I can just dismiss it. This is, really, really genius psychology at play to use this. And you have to use this. You have to be a genius with this. Otherwise, it's too difficult. It's too difficult. If you don't find these ways to get past it, it's too difficult. Now, the people who use drugs and stuff, they don't understand this practice. They don't have this practice. They don't know. They're ignorant of it. So for them, they say, gosh, there's no way. So I've got to use drugs. Otherwise, I'm just going to get utterly depressed. Well, guess what? You use drugs, you do end up getting utterly depressed. Okay. Yeah, ultimately you do. Okay, really depressed. Really bad, really bad. Wow. But the shortcut, they say, I don't know how to get free of these death vows. I really don't know how to do it. But I got to do it somehow. So let me take some drugs. Makes me feel better for a while. But now I feel even worse than before. I got to take more. Now I'm developing a tolerance. Now I'm taking even more. Now I'm really feeling terrible. I got to use a harder drug to get the same euphoria. I got a tolerance for that. Now I'm feeling even worse. I got to take even more, even more, even more. Unfortunately, these people do not have the psychological savvy that is required, because when you start blacking out history of people who have succeeded in the savvy, you're not going to know what the savvy is, and you become dependent on drugs then, and then you become even more depressed, more nihilistic, more quantification fixation, more spiritual idealism not grounded in practice, and you become unhinged. You become unhinged, become overly weird, you're overcompensating with too much weirdness, and the whole thing falls apart. So this savvy is extremely important, to have this savvy. You have to realize that this sort of savvy is possible for you. You can do this. It's not so difficult, actually, is it? You just give absolute minimal acknowledgement of these death vows. Okay, it's an anomaly. Minimal acknowledgement, meaning it's just an anomaly. It's got no basis, actually, in what I'm doing right now at all. It's an ancient anomalistic artifact. That's all it is. Just one label to it only deserves just my attention, just to label it one, give a definition label. Okay, I've done that, fine. I've categorized it. It's wow. I know exactly what it is. That satisfies a psychological, satisfies us psychologically. We do that, and now, gone. Out of the picture. Pushed it off the side. You don't trash it. You just push it off to the side. So be gentle and kind. Part of forgiveness is you don't trash yourself. Okay, you don't trash yourself. So you push it off to the side. Ease it out of the picture. Ease it off to the side of the picture. But you be very kind to yourself. Do not trash yourself. So we're not saying we're not like incinerating it and killing it and trashing it. No. It's an anomaly. It's wow. Pushing you out of the pit, pushing you to the edge of the picture, off to the edge. You sweep it to the edge of the driveway. One broom, just sweep it to the edge of the driveway. It's out of the. It's no longer focusing on it at all. But at least you're not trashing yourself, because keep in mind these death vows have come from our own creativity. Okay, and we don't want to trash our creativity. Okay, but we understand we don't want to use our creativity in that way anymore. Okay, off to the side. But don't trash yourself. Never trash yourself. Be very strict, but don't stop short of trashing yourself. So I do the path of forgiveness. I feel it's a little more sophisticated than just saying you got to kill the ego or you got to no. You don't have to kill the ego. You just label as an ancient anomaly. It's wow, I'm not interested anymore. It's off to the side of the picture. You push it off the side of the picture. Okay, like that, just like that, real quick. But gently, gently. Okay. So we avoid trashing ourselves here. We avoid trashing ourselves. We don't go to that extent. Okay. It's possible, I guess, to do it that way. But the language we use here is respecting our creativity. We respect our creativity, because if you trash your creativity, this could cause a problem for you, actually. So we know we don't trash our creativity. We've been using our creativity in a very strange way, right? Trying to circumvent impossibility, but it's still an idea. Can we circumvent impossibility? That's an idea. And do we have enough creativity to do that? We wanted to find out. So we're still, it's still very much an idea, and then the creativity involved with pursuing this idea. So we don't trash the basis of it all. We don't trash that. We're free to do that. We're free to have this idea. We're free to see how creative we can be in trying to circumvent a possibility. We're free to do this. And we have tried to do this. So don't forgive. We forgive ourselves. We don't trash ourselves. We forgive ourselves. We don't trash ourselves. Now, but you have to give, you don't trash the teachers who do say kill the ego, because they're speaking to a certain type of person who are so clever that it's a challenge for them. It's, how do I kill the ego? Yeah, how do I kill something? Because they're so caught up in the death dream that you have to approach them like, says, you know what? You've been killing, you know, a whole universe of full of killing, right? It's how clever you are. But let's see if you can kill the ego. And they say, hey, that's a great death challenge. Let's see if I can find a way to kill the ego. Okay, so that works for certain types. It works for certain types. But for our types, it's forgiveness is better. It's a for better path for a lot of people. Not for everyone. There's some types that they say, you know, kill the ego. And they say, all right, that's the ultimate challenge, the ultimate creative challenge. How do I kill the ego? But of course, they come back to teacher to teacher. I've been trying to kill the ego for so long. It doesn't work. And they say, well, just keep trying. And eventually, somehow, they come to a point where they just give up or something, and then they have a breakthrough. So that, you know, there is psychology for that type also. But we don't trash ourselves like that. We don't try to kill anything. We're just reversing these vows, reversing and turning these vows into forgiveness vows. And then ultimately we realize we don't even need any vows at all. But we're not trying to destroy these vows. We're not on a mission of destruction here. We're on a mission of reversing these vows. So opting out, you see, opting out of I. I'm opting out of these vows. Opting out, not killing the vows, not destroying them, not trashing them, opting out. So opting out of I, opting out of I, opting, just opting out of I, and opting into now. Opting out of I, opting into now. Opting out of I, opting into now. So that's a gentle, forgiving way where we're honoring our creativity by doing it this way, so that we don't feel estranged from our creativity, like we did something wrong. We didn't do anything wrong. We just chose an idea, and we experienced this idea. And now we decide we don't want this to choose this idea anymore. That's all. We chose this idea, seeing if we can do the impossible, circumvent impossibility. It's been a wild, crazy trip, okay? And now we're saying, okay, enough of this idea. Okay, fine. That's all. God's not judging, doesn't judge us for the ideas that we choose. We're free to choose any idea we want to. If we want to choose the idea of circumventing impossibility, God doesn't judge us for that. But we can certainly decide, you know what? I think I'm done with this idea. I want to move on from this idea, you know. It's an anomaly. It's a wow. Anomalies, wow. Okay, out of the picture for now. Okay, out of the picture for now. Like that. So this is a kinder, gentler, more forgiving sort of approach, but also very wise approach. Don't trash your creativity. Don't trash it. We have to still use it. I mean, that's what we are. We are the induced creativity of the always-onness, yesing light. The omnipresent, always-onness, yesing light induces creativity everywhere. That's what we are. We are this induced creativity. We can't help but fly on the wings of induced creativity. That's what we are. So we have to still be creative. Yeah, we can't just stop being creative. We have to continue to be creative. So we don't want to trash our creativity. The omnipresent, always honest, yesing light isn't just doing nothing. It's inducing endless creativity. It's creative. It induces this endless creativity. Creativitying. It's creativitying. It is ising this creativitying, this essencing, this creativitying is going on in every which way, you know, and it's ceaselessly glorious, ceaseless, glorious experiencing of this, you know, this creativity, ongoing creativitying. That's what's happening. That's reality. It's not just this nothing's happeningness, just this endless stillness of nothing happening. No, everything is happening. Everything is happening. It's this ongoing creativity that is just indescribable. So we are that which is this creativity. You know, we're that flow. We're that flow. That's so, again, honor our creativity, but we have to really reverse these death vows. Okay, that's stifling our creativity. Stifling it, severely stifling it, saying you have to experience this totally extremely stifled creativity until it finally we finally succeed in circumventing impossibility. And we're like, blah, you know, we're so bored. This is blah. This is so boring. Our creativity is so stifled. Jesus said that the electromagnetic light that we're experiencing is like we've stepped down light, freezing it, trying to freeze it till it's like utterly frozen. And he says, that's this electromagnetic universe that you're in. It's like frozen, heavily, heavily frozen light. You've taken your freedom and frozen it down as much as possible. So your creativity is incredibly stifled with this idea of trying to circumvent impossibility. This death dream, trying to circumvent impossibility, stifles our creativity very, very, very severely. And that's why it's such a bummer for us. You know, we're saying like, why? I hate this stifled creativity. It's terrible for us. We're so stifled. To think that we're some person and creativity can only act through a physical, flesh, blood person like this, that is crazy. That is stifling our creativity to an unimaginable extent. And when we become aware of our true creativity, we're just like, wow, that's it for me. Yeah. And it's indescribable. It's so immense. The abundance is so endless, unquenchable abundance of creativity. There's no way to describe it. You can't describe unquenchable, endless, abundancing, delighting, you know, delightfulness. You can't describe that in terms of stifled creativity. It's zero stifled creativity. How could we describe it in terms of extreme stifled creativity? There's no way to effectively represent it or describe it in any way. You know, we tried to represent this in some way or just describe it, define it. That's ridiculous. Because we're using extremely stifled creativity in these efforts to represent it. You know, even the best music, again, it's the same. It's the same. It's the same. Doesn't matter how sophisticated the music is. It's the same. Extreme, extreme, unimaginably stifled creativity. Trying to represent and describe and experience perfectly unstifled, unlimited, unquenchably abundant creativity. That's a joke. That's a joke to think that we can do that. And it's a joke to think that we could ever be even remotely satisfied with some sort of physical utopia like that we could, like this world, you know, in the context of this world, trying to make it like, well, you know, everybody's, you know, you can order this like skin cream from Amazon and express delivery, they get it there that day because there's a drone warehouse near you. And so I could really use this, you know, this really good hand cream. It's like organically sourced. All the ingredients are, you know, organically sourced. We know where it comes from. It's from the sustainable gardens and these lovingly tended plants. And they got this hand cream from that, you know, from these exotically loved seeds, pods. And you can get it today. Within like 4 hours, this drone delivers it to you from the Amazon warehouse. And you can now apply this cream to your hands and you feel so much better about yourself. And you say, now this is creativity. We're really getting there. Really getting there as you got your locally sourced hipster microbrew, you know, to make you feel better. And tonight you got this, you know, totally legal delivered to you, you know, psychogenic drugs that you're going to take this wonderful drug trip in your floating in your isolation chamber, you know, and then after that you're going to take, you know, you're going to have a wonderful shower with organically sourced, you know, botanicals and recycled everything. I mean, you're a complete eco hipster, right? And you say, this is it, total eco hipster. That's it. Now I'm really creative. So beware of the eco-hipster trip. Okay, nothing wrong with being an eco-hipster. Okay, respect for eco-hipsters. However, understand what's going on and what the trip is pulling you into. Thinking, hey, you know, I can be satisfied with totally stifled creativity. Can't. You end up with severe mental illness down the road. And you don't want that, okay? You're gonna find out anyway. You're gonna find out. Don't say that someone didn't tell you, okay? You're gonna end up with a mental illness, and you're gonna say, "Wow, this is so terrible. I repent of everything." You know, I'm willing to give up this whole nonsense right now because this is horrible. This mental illness, horrible, way worse than any physical illness, way worse. You just get this ennui of this, say, like. You know, it just like I'm stuck forever in this total unsuitableness. There's nothing I can do about it. And I don't even feel like ordering my organic, my totally lovable skin cream anymore. And it doesn't really matter if Amazon gets it here 15 minutes sooner. Nothing matters anymore. Total nihilism, total nihilism. Nothing matters, nothing works. You go into this extreme mental illness. And then you say, and there's no way out. I have not a clue how to get out. But then you ask for help, and then the inner guru shows up immediately, and the inner guru says, don't worry, we got this. We got this. There's a way. We got this. And that's what happened with me. The inner guru showed up, and on Easter, we'll call it the Holy Spirit. I didn't call it the Holy Spirit. I just said something, some reassurance showed up immediately that I realized that they were genuinely confident. This inner reassurance was genuinely confident, and I realized this is legit. And this inner reassurance says, don't worry, there's a way out of this. I'll show you how to do it, and you'll succeed, no doubt about it. And I could tell that this was coming from genuine source, and I said, wow, this is honesty. This is true competence, true certainty, true competence. I said, okay. Trusted it right away. I said, okay, I trust you. No doubt about it. So that's what happens when you really bottom out and even the drugs don't help you anymore. Then this, you ask, you say, I need help. And then this help shows up, will show up instantly as some sort of assurance that there is a way out of this. Whereas before you said, there's no way out of this. I'm such an organic hipster that I can't even find any way out of this death dream. That's how hip I am. That's what happens when you get on that trip. You know, you say, yeah, there is no way out of the death dream. And now I'm completely hip, except I feel absolutely like I want to not exist anymore, you know. And then you say, help, this is beyond horrible. You go through mental chaos first. You say, maybe mental chaos will help. No, it doesn't. Okay, I'm doomed, completely doomed. And the help arrives, says, no, there's a way out. There's a way out. And there is a way out. And you're experiencing this now. You're saying, hey, you know, somebody knows there's a way out and it's working. And they're sharing the advice and the tips, the know-how, sharing the know-how of how to keep your poise as you're going along on this path out of this despair. You have to keep your poise. Got to keep your poise. Don't try to be a take charge personality, okay? Just lay low, fly under the radar. Don't take on too much responsibility. Fly under the radar, okay? Fly under the radar. And, okay. Yeah, fly under the radar. Don't take too much responsibility. Keep your poise, keep your poise, keep your poise. You're gonna be a little loopy. As you keep working on this stuff, you're not going to be totally with it. You're not going to be out there, say, making $1 billion. Okay, that's fine. Poverty, chastity, patience, you know, tolerance, all these great virtues. Just practice these great virtues. It's okay. You're not some alpha person in the world. The world is looking for guidance into how to be like a perfect, you know, perfect hipster, organic hipster. Perfectly sourced hipster. They're not looking to you for all the answers to be a perfectly sourced hipster. Okay, that's okay, because you're getting out of your death vows. You know, you're getting out of the death vows. So someday you'll be truly hip, you know. You'll be a reality hipster. You're going to be a reality hipster someday. Yeah. A spiritual path hipster, a reality hipster, you know. Then you'll say, wow, this is way better, you know, way better being that kind of hipster. A guru hipster, true guru hipster, reality hipster, wow. A wow hipster. Yeah, you'll be a wow hipster. There you go. A wow hipster. And that's where you really want to be hip. You really want to be a wow hipster because you know how to keep your poise, and which enables you to reverse these death vows into forgiveness vows, and ultimately, you won't even need any vows at all. That's where you want to be hip. So I said to the boomers, boomers, you know, thanks, but I want to be truly hip. You know, I want to be truly hip here. I'm here to be a wow hipster. Okay, not a cannabis hipster, not an organic food hipster, or anything like that, but a wow hipster. Nothing wrong with being organic. I try to eat organic food. I'm basically a vegan. You know, occasionally I eat some yogurt occasionally. You know, so I can't brag about being a vegan, right? But you know, but just about, you know, that close, right? Can't get in the club. That's fine. Because they're getting too hipsterish about it, right? You know, I'm a vegan. Like, yeah, I've got it made. I really understand what it's all about now. But I'm very, you know. So, but no, being a vegan is great. It's good for you. Being a vegetarian is really good for you. And if you're not, that's also fine too. But if you want to be an organic hipster, that's good. That's fine. Take care of the planet. That's good. That's fine. But keep in mind that none of that is being truly hip. You also need to be a wow hipster, meaning you have to know how to maintain your poise as you go into that death vow dungeon. Scary place to go into. Scary place. Yeah. I've been into it thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of times. And, you know, at the first, it was too scary. You know, scary. And it's always scary to go in there and say, okay, I've got to clean house. I got to keep cleaning house here. I know there's some vows left. What monster's going to come after me today? You know, it's scary. Yeah. And so just opting out of I, 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 opting out of I. Wow. Just opting out of I. Wow. Just opting out of I, opting out of I, just opting out of I and opting into now. Just opting out of I, just opting out of I, just opting out of I and opting into now. That's the one I'm doing today. But each day you go into there, some, you know, you may have to, you know, realize, like, hey, you know, I need something to deal with this monster, this horrible, horrible death vow that's coming at me in a certain way, that I just need a certain way to neutralize that and reverse it. And maybe some people just use the same tactic every single time. Maybe that works. I don't have a lot of faith in that, to tell you the truth. But if there's some that do it, that would be fine. But they should not trash those who use a variety of practices, a variety of techniques. Are, you know, I ask every day, okay, give me a practice that's going to work today, that'll motivate me to go into that death vow dungeon. And so oftentimes I get a practice, every different practice every day that's slightly different, that I feel like, okay, this will help me. And then go in there and go after, you know, say, opting out of I, that's very powerful. Opting out of I and opting into now. 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 Very powerful practice. Very powerful practice. So the practices get more powerful and more sophisticated as you go along. Now, some people want to just use one thing. Okay, if maybe so for some people that works. It doesn't necessarily work for everyone. It didn't work for me. Didn't work for me. One attitude, that's it. My creativity kind of demanded, you know, my vows are very, death vows are very creative. So I got to use a lot of creativity to reverse those death vows. Maybe some people's death vows are not as creative, possible, right? But I imagine I used a lot of creativity to put these death vows in. Being very creative, we all are very creative, but some may have just used sort of just like, a minimal death vow. And so they can just use one sort of thing to just neutralize, reverse that. Possible, right? Possible, possible, possible. kind of iffy about it, but you know, it's theoretically it's possible. But in order to imagine, stifle your creativity so that down to the point you think that you're a human being, you put a lot of creativity into that. We put a massive amount of creativity in that. So it's very unlikely that you just put a little bit of creativity there, because you never would have stifled your creativity down to the point where you're believing that you're this human being here, subject to death. That takes a tremendous commitment of vowing, a massive amount of vowing to get to that point, a massive amount. So don't think that you're this death vow ingenue that says, oh no, I just have a little bit. I just love it away and it's just gone like that. It's so easy, you know. Don't fall for that. We've got a massive amount of death vows in that death vow dungeon. A massive amount to get to the point where we've stifled. We believe that we're these human bodies and that's it. That's an incredible stifling of our creativity. That's not easy to do, to stifle it. You have to put immense vows on yourself, intense, immense, fearful vows. Don't ever touch these vows, or you're going to be annihilated into an abyss. If you ever go into this death dungeon, you will be annihilated into an abyss. These are the kind of vows that we've told ourselves so that we don't go close to this dungeon. We've told ourselves that if we even get close to this dungeon, we're going to be thrown into a lake of burning fire and annihilated forever. You know, can't even get close to this dungeon. So we got all these defenses telling us, don't go further. You're going to be, you know, just wiped out and you're going to suffer the worst hellfire ever. And we've put all these barriers of fear so we don't get down into those vows and say, hey, wait a minute, I'm going to reverse that vow. So most folks just, you know, say, whoa, I better not go down there. So what can I do? What the heck can I do? Oh, let me just say, I love this world so much. It's so much fun. You know, I love you too. Let's have some fun here, you know. No, they're scared to go, you know, through these defenses. You have to get through all this defensiveness that we have, that we've told ourselves all these lies, all these vows that you're going to be destroyed if you do this. God's going to destroy you. Never true. But I've been through thousands of these defenses. And each one tells you that something horrible is going to happen to you if you go through that. No, all lies. God doesn't punish anyone for anything. Okay? God just is always on this yesing light. Omnipresent, always on this yesing light, inducing unlimited, unquenchably abundant creativity. Unquenchably abundant, delighting creativity, okay? Unquenchably abundant, endlessly delighting creativity. Unquenchably abundant, endless delighting creativity. Unquenchably abundant, endless delighting creativity. That's what God is. And God is never anything other than that. And we can't change that. We cannot change that. Doesn't matter how much we stifle our creativity. Can't change it. Can't change it at all. So there is no God saying you can't go into these death vows and reverse and relinquish them. No, those are our own creativity trying to scare ourselves. Boogie monster is going to get you. If you go past this door, this boogie monster is going to get you. You open the door and there's these death vows there and you say, wow. Okay, I got to get to work on this. You know, this is not good. Yeah, so behind this door is what? Another death vow. Okay, behind this door, oh, you know, darker death vows. Gee, scary. It is scary. But it's all nonsense, okay? So you got to have some sense of humor, but not too much gallows humor. I mean, because you get to a point where you get silly about it, you know. No, it's still scary. You got to do the work. You got to still do the work. You know, it's ultimately we'll have a good laugh at it once the work is done. But you don't want to get into this laughter silliness too much. You know, the people get stuck in that too. Like, let's just all have a cruise and have fun and sit silly and laugh. Oh yeah, yes. And avoid the tough work. No, you got to open that next door too. And then behind that next door, there's some even heavier vows. And you say, wow, the whole I vow thing, I've got to reverse that whole I thing. There is no I, actually. That was just that's just another vow. We're vowing that we're going to believe that there's this I that's experiencing the success of the stifled creativity death dream. there isn't anyone experiencing any success because there isn't any success. So this belief that there's an I or a soul that's experiencing the success of this death dream is itself just a silly vow that we need to reverse. So opting out of I, opting out of I, opting out of I, and opting into now. Opting out of I, opting out of I, just opting out of I, and opting into now. Opting out of I, opting out of I, just opting out of I, and opting into now. So I'm using this practice to deal with this, you know, very heavy vow to believe that there's some I that's experiencing the success of this dream. No success. So how could there be an I experiencing the success? It can't be. There isn't any I. So it's an I vow, opting out of I, you know, to believe in time where should we believe that there's some success happening, some progress happening. We can't change reality, so there's no progress happening in the changing of reality. Reality is not changing at all. It's not changing at all. Not changing at all. But don't hate yourself if it's scary. Of course it's scary. I don't sit there and say, gee, I can't wait to open up this next door, you know, go deeper in the dungeon. No, I'm not saying that. I'm just like, wow, can I avoid this somehow? Can I avoid this somehow? Ah, my life's still boring. I'm still stuck. I'm still dreary existence. Oh my gosh, there's no fun. I can't have fun in any way. It's okay. I can't avoid it. I really can't avoid it. Ah, horrible. Okay. All right, let me just psych myself up. I'm going to open up this door, open the next door. Ha! There's another death vow monster there. I say, okay, how do I deal with this thing? Wow, this yuck. This darkness, this horrible octopus-like darkness that's trying to grab you. Yeah, you know, it's not fun. Not that much fun. And I pray, God, give me the practice, give me the right practice. I need a practice. And opting out of I, just opt out of I, just opting out of I, opting out of I. That's what happened this morning. I said, okay, I've got to go further. Scary. I need a practice help. Opt out of I, just opting out of I, just opting out of I, opting out of I. Wow, opting out of I, just opting out of I, opting out of I, just opting out of I, opting out of I. Wow, opting out of I, opting out of I. So this practice just came to me. It just. I allow the practices to emerge. Just allow them. I give them permission to emerge. Give these practices permission to emerge, and they will. They always have. I've done thousands and thousands of practices. But they're all basically assertion practices like this. And I just allow them to emerge. And then somehow I just say, oh, opting out of I. There it is. It's in my mind. Opting out of I, opting out of I, opting out of I. Then I begin developing it. Opting out of I, opting out of I, opting out of I. Just opting out of I and opting into now. Opting out of I, opting out of I. Just opting out of I and opting into now. Now is now, opting into now. I forgive myself and relinquish the vow of opting into I and opting out of now. I forgive myself and relinquish the vow of opting into I and opting out of now. We don't need any time to tell us it's now. Okay. We need time to tell us, you know, what's relative to, you know, it's 3:49 relative to some other time. But now is always right now. We don't need any time to say that it's now. it's now is timeless. It's now. It's now. That's a subtle thing. It's hard to accept it. Yeah, it's a whole perspective shift. But time is only relative to other time. It's never identifying now at all, actually. Because we don't need a number or a label for it to be right now. It's always right now. It's always right now. Time just means from right now, how far ago was that past and how much in the future is this future? But in terms of right now, it's always right now. We don't need any time frame to experience right now. We don't need a time frame to experience now. Reality doesn't require a time frame. Reality is always unquenchably abundant right now. So time has to do with accumulation. How much lack of abundance did I used to have, and how much more abundance am I going to get in the future? So time is always based on this lack of unquenchable abundancy. And, you know, how much death has there been in the past and how much death is going to be in the future. So it's a way of quantifying. Time is a quantification mechanism. But now, it doesn't need to be quantified. It's just, it's right, all, it's totally here right now. So some people, you see this, and it's a major perspective shift. Don't worry if you don't see it. I don't see it that often. I don't see it that often. But sometimes I see through this. You see through time completely. Just time. Phew. See through, right through time. You know, it's time worshiping, which is death worshiping. We're just keeping track of how much death there is. How much death have we accumulated? That's all we're doing. And how much will we accumulate in the future to give us some hope? But we'll get more in the future. So there's hope because there's time. Right now, I don't have enough. We say, I don't have enough death right now. But I do have endless, unquenchable abundancing and delighting in that right now. That's what I have right now. See, right now, we have reality is right now. That unquenchable abundancing is right now. We have that right now. But we never have enough death right now, do we? So then we say, well, I need more time for more death to happen. Yeah, we never have enough death to change reality. But time keeps that hope alive. That, you know, because I have to contrast, you know, this time with that time over there where we didn't have enough death. We've got more death possibilities now. If we love this world, we say we're going to stick with this world. Oh, good. We say, oh, good. We're going to have a lot more deathing possibilities then. If we keep with this world, just think of billions and billions and billions more of death. That's, wow, we're going to really be able to have so much more death. Get the ecosystem really good so it produces a lot of organic life. So all that stuff deaths and goes back to inorganic life. So that's what time is for. But we don't need time for right now because we have unquenchable abundancing right now. That's reality because reality hasn't changed, which means it's present right now. It's always the same unquenchable abundancing. Reality doesn't change. Always on this yesing light, always is yesing to everything. We're inducing creativity everywhere. So always on this yesing light is inducing creativity everywhere. The unquenchable abundancing of everlasting delighting is always right now. So either we experience now or experience I. Either experiencing now or time worshiping. What are the two? So opting out of I means we're opting into now. So when we opt out of I, we're automatically opting into now. If we opt out of now, if we want to try and opt out of now, we're automatically opting into I, which is this time game of accumulation, of hoping we'll accumulate enough death, dying, to circumvent an impossibility of changing reality. Hope. Never happens. Will never happen. Will never happen. So the waiting, you know, eventually you get tired of waiting. I'm tired of waiting. I'm tired of having my creativity stifled to this most extreme extent. And occasionally we get glimpses of our creativity that's not as stifled. Occasionally, you know, we get... Then we just say, oh my gosh, I'm missing out on all of this just in order to die, just to keep track of all this organic life that's dying into inorganic condition. I'm just waiting for that, and it doesn't even work. And I'm missing out on all this fabulous creativity I could be experiencing. That's a bummer. Yeah, that's a real bad bummer. Wow, what can I do about this? Horrible. Well, then you got to, you know, reverse and relinquish those vows. Reverse those vows into forgiveness vows. I forgive myself for this death dream vow. You know, I forgive myself and relinquish the vow of imagining this death dream wow. So, example of a forgiveness vow is a death-free realm, a pure land. You can actually experience a pure land or a death-free realm. That's a forgiveness vow. It's still a vow. Okay, it's still a vow. Creativity is still somewhat stifled there. It's still somewhat stifled, okay. But it's an intermediate step. It's a forgiveness vow. And from there, you will realize you don't need any vows at all. And once you realize you don't need any vows, then you experience the fullness of your creativity. Creativity is no longer stifled. You don't feel your creativity is stifled. But we're a ways away from that. We're so used to our creativity being extraordinarily, extremely stifled, that to go directly into creativity being no stifling at all, pure, free creativity, this is seems like too big of a jump for us. Too big of a jump for us. So it's really helpful to have forgiveness vows. Reverse death vows into forgiveness vows. Ultimately, we'll experience a death-free realm, the Pure Lands, incredibly, wonderfully beautiful, but still, we will realize this is still not quite, you know, creativity is still stifled quite a bit. We understand that. It's an intermediate step, no problem. And from there, we will then relinquish all vows and no more stifling our creativity. That's what's going to happen for us. This is our aim. But right now, with this blackout, man, they're really stifling our creativity, aren't they? In order to channel it in the direction that they want, the meager bit we have, we want them to be, just tell us what to do. Just tell us how to lift this lockdown, you know. Just, what do we got to do? You say, okay, you could be creative again, but you're going to have to do it this way. You mean I can't go back to the way it used to be in 1980? No. You can't. They're going to say, no, you're going to have to get with the program. Son, come on now. But you could be very creative, yeah, as long as you get with the program. Well, just tell us what the program is, because we're going crazy here. Yeah. So you understand how clever the blackout is? First, they lock everything down. That's the first step. Psychologically, you're locked down. You can't do anything. Then they begin to ease restrictions. However, you've got to play by their rules now going forward. Everybody's got to play by these rules. You got to have a card that says you got the antibodies. You got to have a card that you're immune. Otherwise, you can't do anything, right? So come on and get that vaccine. You got to get a card. You want to do something? Okay, get the vaccine. Get hooked into vaccine culture. Oh, there's another problem. Yeah, you got all sorts of potential illnesses. You need those vaccines too. Okay, so you're going to be ended up getting endless vaccines, okay? And then they'll overreach, you know, keep overreaching step by step by step, overreach step by step by step until you're in blackout culture, 2030 blackout culture. You got to have the right perspective on history now. If you have a wrong perspective, gee, you need to be re-educated. Do you have your re-education certificate? So there will be a re-education certificate you need to have, which you need to forsake. You know, forsake your vows of Easter, like we can overcome death with Jesus, psychological practices, and all this stuff, you know, the saints. You got, you haven't been re-educated yet. So you got to get a re-education certificate. You go to re-education centers to get your re-education certificate. This is down the road a little bit. Quote, unquote, re-education centers. Now, what happens if you can't be re-educated? Well, you know, then they got to try certain drugs on you. Oh yeah, biotech help. Don't worry, we got that too. We'll change your genetic strands, and then you'll understand how history really was, you know. And so, yeah, of course. Have you had did you have genetic stranding so you've been certified? So what they're doing is this massive certification program. Well, you're going to have to jump through every hoop imaginable to be able to even function here. In China, what they do is you can't even go out right now. You know, they're testing out this beta testing of your living. You can't leave your home unless you're tested for virus. You know, they have temperature sensors. They ask you questions about, and they make sure that you are, you know, do you have your antibody certificate, et cetera, et cetera. If you do, you get a green light on your cell phone, this green bar on your cell phone, which you can activate. You activate your bar. It's an app. And so if you want to go anywhere, do anything, any transportation, walk on the street, go into a restaurant, buy food, buy necessities of life, buy pharmaceuticals, do anything, you have to have this green light on your app bar. It's a government app. The green light means you've been certified that you can function in society. If they feel that you are a risk to society in any way, they put a red bar on this app. And so in this red bar, you say, show me your bar. You do on your app. Oh, there's a red bar. Sorry, you can't buy anything here. You can't shop. You got to go back to your house and lock yourself in isolation. You cannot function in society. That's how it is in China. So that just shows you what's coming. It's already in China, folks. And it's going to be adopted around the world. Well, your smartphone, you will have to show. And people will dispense with smartphones and just get a chip. This other, you know, just get a chip, you know, just real quick. You know, I'm chipped. That, you know, wireless will pick that up, or some technology will pick that up. And so you're legit. I'm chipped and legit. Wow. I'm a legit, I'm a chipped hipster. Wow. Chip legit hipster. Wow. chip legit hipster. Wow. No, I'm not a chip hip. Legit hipster. Wow. And yeah, that's what's coming. You have to be a chip legit hipster. Wow. Oh, man. Or else you won't be able to function in society. And this has been, we've been warned about that. Christians have been warned about that for a long, long time. There's a culture will get to the point where if you aren't legit chipped hipster, you won't be able to function in society at all. Mark of the Beast, they're calling, or something like that. 666, social distancing, 666. Yep, Mark of the Beast, 666. So yeah, the warnings have gone out, and people are aware of this, but this is what's coming. Certification, so much certification. Now, I've always hated certification. Forms. I'm totally anti-forms, filling out forms, trying to certify myself in any way. I refuse to do it. I'm really so anti-certification because I know what's coming. And the more you accept certification, the easier it is to be dragged through this certification process of the blackout. So by the end of, by 2030, you will be a legit certified hipster. Wow. Certified legit hipster. Wow. And you'll be able to function in society. How about that? And you'll get the real inside skinny of what history was really about. It was really about overcoming these terrible, crazy religious people who thought that they could overcome death. But no, now we're totally hip to our real purposes, right? Which is just like to eco-farm the planet, man. Let's just like totally eco-farm it. Make it like unbelievably, yeah. But what about your stifled creativity? See, there's the fly in the ointment, right? The fly in the ointment is your stifled creativity. Your creativity is so extremely stifled here. And they don't want anybody. They say, no. We got computers now, man. We'll make really cool music. We'll make really cool graphics. We'll make really cool holograms. Wow, we're so amazing. Our creativity is just like blossoming into ultimacy. No, it's not. It's still totally, incredibly stifled. Totally. But they don't want you having these inner experiences where you realize, hey, that's my real creativity. That's what I want. This other stuff, forget it. See you later. They don't want that. No. They're gonna control your creativity. So it's at a certain level. Say, wow, okay, you're a total creative hipster right now, right? Because you're staying at that certified level. You got you certified at this level. What a total certified creative hipster you are. Wow. Yes. And you say, okay, so I fit in. Good, but I still feel like something isn't quite right, right? That's not quite right. It's my stifled creativity. Yeah, but they said that's all a myth. They said it was just a myth. It was made up by a bunch of maniacs back then. And we're supposed to forget about it. We're supposed to label it some crazy anomaly. Jesus teaching, crazy anomaly. Whew. Off to the side for them with that. That's zone 4 blackout, baby. Totally hip. Totally unhip, unsourced, totally unorganic, totally unhip, 2030 blackout culture, wow. Totally unsourced, totally unorganic, totally unhip, blackout, 2030 blackout culture, anomaly, wow. Anomaly, wow. Okay, right? So we need to practice in that way of relinquishing these vows to do that, because it really is, there's nothing more unorganic than dreaming a death dream. There's nothing more unlocally sourced than stifling your creativity. Okay. There's nothing more unhip than refusing to relinquish those death vows that are causing you to be totally unsourced, extremely unorganic, extremely unhip, all that stuff. So you're like the anti-hipsters, actually. 2030, the anti-hipster generation. Totally unhip. And yet they think they're like extremely hip, but actually they're extremely unhip. Extremely non-locally sourced, extremely unorganic, extremely unhip. And extremely bad for our psychological environment. Devastating to the psychological environment. Devastating to mental health. See, that's not very hip. That's like unhip. That's like very, very unhip. So we got to be the true wow hipsters here and have the understand the technique of reversing those death vows and preventing them from coming back on us. It's cycle. How we doing here? Doing pretty good, huh? Yeah. So, you know, people love, you love these long videos, which is great because I love to do them. And the time duration, 30 minutes per video, that's unheard of for videos. It's unheard of. So I was like, wow, okay, long videos. Great. I'm having a great time doing this. This you couldn't have a better Easter than this. This is the best Easter ever. You know, cheers. Distilled water. We got like 100 gallons. We get 100 gallons of distilled water a time. And so our mandate here is we got to drink those 100 gallons of distilled water. We've already gone through 100, and now we're starting on our second 100. And yes, we take vitamins to make up for the lack of trace minerals in the distilled water. But this water is really great. Locally sourced. It is locally sourced. Very organic. Yes, it is. It's distilled, locally sourced hipster water. Wow. So basically 2033 is you're not allowed to be a true hipster at all. It's illegal. It's uncertifiable. You will be uncertifiable. So everybody's working on actually being incredibly unhip here. Because being truly hip is you have psychological sophistication in order to know how to keep your poise so you can go down into the death vow dungeon and reverse the death vows and into forgiveness vows. That's the really only definition of hip we have in this world. Nothing else is truly hip at all. It's very unhip to not do this. To not do this is the very essence of unhipness. You got that? Yeah. But it's not, you know, in 2030, you see, you're uncertifiable. Gee, well, we're certainly certifiable somewhere, okay? If you want to make us uncertifiable here, we'll just take our forgiveness vows and extend them, okay? We'll just use our forgiveness vows to, you know, yeah, to make sure we have a place where we're very certified, where being truly hip is extremely certifiable. Right? Yeah. Yes, indeed. So now, you know, we're really getting to it here. And if you've stayed with us the whole time, amazing. Cheers. Yeah. Easter. Well, on Easter, you know, we're having a blowout here. I said I have a dance party. Well, this is our dance party, isn't it? It's a true hipster dance party. It's what real hipsters have as a dance party right here. Can I eat something? Yeah, I might even. I think I might even go for this cliff shot. Yeah. Is this organic? Let me see if it's organic. I don't think it's organic. I can't eat this. Mega Omega Trail Mix: walnuts, dried mango, almonds, cranberries, pumpkin seeds. Well, that's nice. But where are they sourced from? Okay, it's got a non-GMO project. Non-GMO project there. It's gluten-free. Oh, awesome. It's vegan. Woo! It's verified non-GMO product. Gluten-free and vegan. But is it completely certified? I don't know. Dried cranberry? No. It doesn't say it's all organically grown. I got a problem with this. I got a big problem with this. I don't know. This might make me unhip. It's possible, right? If I eat this, I might lose my certification, my hipster certification, my 2030 hipster certification. I've been working on that so hard, you know. It's like, if I eat some of this, I'm going to lose some important points because it's not organically grown. Let me see. So got omega-3, heart healthy, antioxidants, dash of protein, be rich, healthy snack, and it's, you know, it's got all this great stuff, but it comes up just short of certification because it's not all organically grown. All right, don't tell anyone, because I'm going to lose some points. If you tell anyone, I'm going to lose some points, my 2030 hipster certification points. Wow. That's a guilty pleasure, you know. It's horrible. I feel so guilty. My certification is at risk. Oh, well. I got a feeling they might have trouble certifying me, you know, at some point. It might happen. Certification problems here. I got some certification problems here. Can you help me with that? Now, people are going to all these certification gurus. Yeah, I'm kind of worried, like 2030, you know, how am I going to be certified? I got to find some certification experts that'll like train me up how to be truly hip, 2030 hipster. And so people are be going to all these people. Yep, help me be certified, please. I'm feeling really kind of worried about it. Wow. I still feel like kind of, I believe that, you know, there might be a way to, you know, maybe get liberated from this mess. Is that possible? I'm worried, you know, people like worry about that. Subconsciously, they feel like, I don't know if I'm certifiable. Well, I'll tell you what, pay enough money, you might be certifiable. So everybody in the millennials and Gen Zers, oh my God, they're ferociously after certification. That's all they think about. I got to do this. This will help me be certified. So I've got a roadmap to certification going on. Okay, I need to work on this organically, you know, locally sourced farm that's non-GMO, and you know, they're you know, doing alpaca blankets, and you know, they got to, you know, heap on all this hipster eco stuff because they're worried, like, you know, I gotta get certified by 2030. I gotta get certified. Otherwise, I won't be able to function here. They know this. There's the very fanaticism shows you they know certification is coming. And they're scared, really scared. They may not be certified. They know that they won't be able to function if they're not certified. This is an open secret in the world, right? Otherwise, they wouldn't be behaving the way they're behaving. They're scared because they know that the hell that's coming, that they've scripted. If they don't make their own certification standards, they're toast. So that's why the millennials and Gen Zers are so intense. They're so intense. You know, they says, don't get in the way of my certification, dude. You know? You're getting in the way of my certification, man. That's a crime. Because I won't be able to function if I'm not certified. And you're the cause of that. So I said, I didn't skip this certification. I didn't cause any of that. You scripted it, you know. You're just running into your own strict standards, you know, of keeping yourself bound to this death stream. I'm helping you be certified as a genuine hipster, so you get to the death-free realms and the pure lands, ultimately, unfettered creativity. Wow, this is really good. I don't know where this came from. It's not even expensive. Where'd this come from? I don't know. So I was just given this as an Easter gift. It's really good. Walnuts, dried mango, almonds, cranberries, and pumpkin seeds. That's the best trail mix I've ever had. And it's all a plot to decertify me by tempting me with this inorganic food, dastardly plot to you. And so, you get people are going to get really paranoid going forward. Everybody's plotting against me to make sure I got decertified, you know. Yeah, paranoia. It's going to go crazy in this world.
Everything's a conspiracy. Everybody's out to get me. Trying to decertify me. Of course, and you know, everybody wants to be monitored. I gotta prove that I'm certifiable. I gotta prove that I'm buying this organic food. I gotta prove that I'm doing this. So certify me, certify everybody, everything they do, trace every last thing they do, so we can know who's certifiable, who's not. And I think I can prove that I'm certifiable. Of course, if everything I do is being traced, what if they find out that I'm doing some things that are not certifiable? It's like, oh man, this is like scary. So they're scaring themselves. Should wear the shirt. Uncertifiable hipster. I'm an uncertifiable hipster. Totally uncertifiable hipster. Wow. Just total uncertifiable hipstering. Wow. Just total uncertifiable hipstering. Wow. Just loving my uncertifiable hipstering, wow. Just delighting in my uncertifiable hipstering, wow. Just shocked by my uncertifiable hipstering, wow. Just delighting in my uncertifiable hipstering, wow. Just loving my uncertifiable hipstering, wow. Just abiding in my uncertifiable hipstering, wow. Okay, so then we're turning it around. You see, we're turning it around. Just shocked by my uncertifiable hipstering. Wow. Just delighting in my uncertible hipstering. Wow. Just loving my uncertifiable hipstering. Wow. Just abiding in my uncertifiable hipstering. Wow. How we do it? Yeah, why not? Right? Yeah. Fly under the radar. But yeah, this is, you know, we've got, thank you, Jesus, right? Motivated us to get into much clearer picture. Okay, now we really, okay, we get the gist of it. But then we're kind of like, just delighting in my uncertifiable hipstering. Wow. Just delighting in my uncertifiable hipstering, 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 wow. Wow, 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 wow. Just delighting in my uncertifiable hipstering, wow. Just delighting in my uncertifiable hipstering, wow. So no one's really certifiable, you see. They'll all fail. And then the bureaucrats will say, okay, none of you passed, but if you promise to like really try really, really hard for the rest of your life and